Hey, welcome. Give me steam. It's Golden VCR. Trill has been a subscriber for 5 months. Give me steam, tape. Thank you, Trill. Circle now squared. 4 month resub. We taping. Facebook has resubbed for 5 months. Hey, would you look at that? 1 month for every time Give Me Steam is mentioned in that one song. Sage of Stars, 5 months. Zelda Master. Oh, right. I have to do that. Hi. Zelda Master, thank you for resubbing at 5 months. Hey, Mr. Golden. Hey, Mr. Golden Tape Man, play that tape for me. Happy to be here. Happy to see you all. How are you? We started a little late because I had to go pick up the dog. We just got back from an out-of-town funeral. It was a very nice service. Let's watch some videotapes. What are we watching today? Maybe I can suggest something. The dog has already been fed. You will all be pleased to know. Happy tape? Yeah, I could do happy tape. Hey, 5 months from Halo 92. Thank you. I sorted by favorites, and the seemingly just 5 month resub. Thank you. Hype Train Level 2, there's not a specific Peter Gabriel for that, but, Give me steam! We can watch Church World Service Hope Amidst Tragedy, a church service about Somalia and Yugoslavia from the 90s. We can watch, what else is there, we can watch Faithful Under Trials, Jehovah's Witnesses in the Soviet Union. We can watch Sudan, Is Time Running Out? But I think we should maybe watch something lighthearted and fun. I like that idea. A 4 month resub from Linders. Thank you. And a 5 month resub from Seemingly Jess. I might have missed that one. Let's go to this. Let's go to the Explore tab. Let's find... Oh, there's a seal tape. Let's find the most good, the most happiest perfect tape. And yes, indeed, Bingo is live on Discord. Thank you to Jacebook for running that community bingo. There is a Discord link if you need it. What if there's something not necessarily for children? Missing No Leader, thank you for the 5 month resub. I'm glad to be back, and it's good to see you all. Wild America, Marty Stouffer's Wild America, Wacky Babies, Red Skelton, King of Laughter, Babysitter's Club. We could do a Richard Simmons and just watch it. Let's see. Tell you what. Let's see. I think I gotta pick something. Hey, a 5 month resub from Will Peters and a level 3 hype train. This has never happened before. Thank you all very much. Will Peters says, hypothetically, a city pays you $5 billion to live in it. You would have to live there. Is this a copy-paste? I think I've seen this before. You'd have to live there for a year and only get paid once you move in. Said city is at the bottom of a giant pit that's 300,000 feet deep. You can dive out. It's just a really long drive. Dive. Okay. The city is at the bottom of a giant... No. That's a hard decision to make, because what... Is the city worth living in? What can I spend that $5 billion on? Does everyone in the city have $5 billion? Because then the currency is basically worthless. Actually, yeah, let's just... I'm going to turn on Richard Simmons' daily affirmations. And then we can figure something out from there. That's a great idea. Exploring the world of fish sounds fun. Exploring the world of fish, brought to you by Shamu. Let me... Oh, I muted myself, I think. I can't do the stream deck. What is it? Richard Simmons. Day by Day with Richard Simmons, Volume 5. We watched some of this before, and it's not like a whole taper. It's a part taper. Friend of Jace Book. Aw. Ricky the Remarkable, a friendly Richard Simmons. I love gender swap cartoon Richard Simmons. I'm gonna go get this tape and we'll watch a little bit of it. And 5 month resub from Aaron the Baron. Thank you. Okay, so we are... We are part of the way through this one. It's a lot of weight loss stuff, but also just good Richard Simmons motivation. And away we go. We're on what? Day 131.
Back in the 60s, Diana Ross recorded a song that talked about reflections. Reflections of the way things used to be. Well, that tune sort of popped into my head the other day, and I couldn't stop humming it. Then it struck me that over the past several months, we have been doing a lot of reflecting on days gone by, too. After all, if you've been following these tapes very closely, you cannot deny that changes are taking place that you probably haven't experienced before. There is a new you emerging from undercover. People are looking at you. Maybe people have known you for a long time, and they are seeing a different person.
Those are some good train conductor Candyland overalls.
They're noticing that you've lost weight, that your body is smaller, your face is thinner, you've changed your hairstyle, you bought new clothes. All of these outward signs indicate to those around you that you are changing. But tell me something, are you recognizing these changes for yourself? When you look in the mirror, do you see that new size staring back at you? Slimmer, healthier, and hopefully happier?
We're getting right back into the 1990s size and weight fixation.
60 pounds ago. Even though you've lost weight, do you still look at yourself and see the same overweight person that you used to be? Sometimes people can't accept.
3 month resub from J-Line Book.
There are people who are afraid
Richard,
to face the fact
I'm 53 kilograms,
new, different, and
which is 116 pounds. I better not be losing weight.
Good fortune by recognizing it. The way we look at ourselves can sometimes be very different than the way others see us. I can't even count the number of letters I get from people telling me that they continue to look at themselves as overweight, even though they're doing so well on Deal a Meal. It's a difficult thing to fight. But if you are going to succeed, then this is one hurdle you have to cross. Here are some of my suggestions so you can learn to look at yourself.
Oh my God, it's a level 3 hype train. Thank you.
Not what it used to look like yesterday.
We really do need a Peter Gabriel emote.
Yourself carefully. Take a good long look. Look at your face and recognize that the person staring back at you is you. It's not an illusion. You're not seeing things. It's you in that mirror. It's the same person that you've looked at ever since you were born. But physically, you have changed. Don't be afraid to accept your new look. And for heaven's sakes, enjoy the changes that are taking place. If you haven't done this, go out and get yourself a new hairstyle and maybe even a makeover. A new body deserves a new look. Don't be afraid to let go of the old ways you've grown used to. Instead, spread your wings a little and take a chance on a change. I think you'll be surprised at how much
Chadwick,
better you feel about
the choo-choo,
and how differently you will look at yourself. Do you remember I told you back in the beginning of this series to give away?
No, Richard, we only have volume 5.
A couple of outfits, and you were probably thinking that I was crazy for wanting you to hang on to those. Well, there is a method to my madness. I want you to pull out those old clothes. It doesn't matter where it's a where there's a pair of pants or a blouse or whatever you've saved.
I have a croissant
to hold up that
that I will now eat. Excuse me.
And look in the mirror. If you haven't realized it up till now, then at that moment you will see you're no longer the person who used to fit into those clothes. Those clothes are a symbol of the.
You're still the same person with the same body.
It's hard sometimes.
You have just
for all of us to accept
made changes.
When it means
through one kind of self-care.
Improve your health and take care of your body. Looking back over the past can never hurt you as long as you realize that you were living in the present and moving ahead towards the future. So take some time today to reflect on how far you have come since day one and the positive changes you have made in your life.
Stand back. Wow. Perfectly timed. Jace Book is getting really good at that.
A few years ago, a mall was for shopping. People would say, where are you going? I'm going to the shopping mall. But now, it's not a shopping mall anymore. It's become an eating mall. Let's go and eat at the mall. Let's spend our whole day eating at the mall. And that is what some people do. Are you one of those people? There are some restaurants in the mall that cater to people who have breakfast, lunch, or dinner in mind. But then there are all these other places that serve free-for-all food. It's what you might term snack food. And you say, oh, what the heck? I'm here in the mall. Let's order it and eat it. And after all, it's just a bun, or it's just a pretzel, or it's just a cookie. It's not as if it was a whole meal, so the calories can't
It's just a croissant.
Ha! This is really not true. These foods are what I call the accessories of the crime of eating in the mall. I guess that some people think if they're just walking and browsing that eating doesn't count, but it does count, and it counts big. Here, let me show you why. I mean, who can resist these? Look at these buns. You can smell them a mile away when you're at the mall. The aroma can suck you in like a vacuum cleaner till before your mind even knows it, your feet have brought you right to the bun counter, and there
you
are.
Those are some good-looking buns.
Ordering one, which you then devour. So what does this bun really cost you in your deal-a-meal cards? Well, come on. Look at the size of this. You know it has to be at least 3 bread cards, maybe 4. These buns aren't called bodacious for nothing. Now we have to account for the raisins and the frostings. This will cost about 3 fruit cards and 2 fat cards. This bun is hardly a snack. What about this pretzel? Well, that can't be so bad. Well, that's true. A pretzel is probably the safest bet at the mall. And it will cost you, this small one, about 1 bread card. Now, if your mall has those cinnamon raisin pretzels drizzled with hot frosting, well, don't kid yourself. Those extras don't come free. That will be an additional 2 fruit cards and a fat card. How do you think you could burn up those calories from one of those giant cookies? Look at the size of this cookie. You'd probably have to walk around the mall about 100 times. Even the regular size cookies, the smaller ones, are bad enough. We'll talk about cookies later next month. Let's face facts here. Going to the mall to shop is one.
There is a dog.
But going there to eat is something.
She's very worn out. Different.
It's far worse than a buffet because, well, this is like a mega buffet. It's a dream come true to be totally surrounded by every kind of food you could wish for. But a nightmare if you actually let yourself eat a whole lot of it and you know you could easily
I
eat
do love buffet.
Stall as you see different foods that tickle your taste buds. Why put yourself in an arena with so much temptation?
Like a,
after all, everything is here in this one.
Do you want a plate of croissant flakes?
Really have the willpower to count your cards at the mall when there are so many tantalizing foods beckoning to you? If you can, then
I... Oh, no, I think I left the fridge open. I hear beeping, and I hear Haley running.
Now, here are a few strategies that might help. First of all, if you eat a proper meal before you leave for the mall, you may be able to avoid the food court altogether. But let's say you have decided to meet a friend there for lunch. How are you going to handle that? First of all, make sure you aren't so hungry when you arrive. Eat some carrot and celery sticks or a piece of fruit.
Oh, the air fryer. Okay.
Then when you get to the food court.
Did you see the apple turnovers?
You plan to use for lunch and arrange your meals around them. And make sure it is a meal, not just a bunch of junky snacks. If you can find some broiled chicken, you can't go wrong with that if you take the skin off, of course. And there's lots of stalls that serve fresh, delicious bread and rolls. Then you can go to another stall to get a green salad. Some malls now sell salad by the pound. So you make the salad exactly
eat 10 pounds of salad.
And priced accordingly. They even have low-cal dressings. How about a baked potato at the mall? That can be an excellent choice, and they'll do it any way you ask. So make sure you order that margarine or butter or sour cream on the side. I love my baked potato with fresh broccoli.
Okay, sorry, this has to go back to being the VCR cam now.
Next time you're at the mall, instead of salivating over the foods that aren't in your best interest, check out all the foods that you can have on your Deal a Meal program. Make a list if you like so that the next time you're at the mall, making the best food decision.
Thank you for enjoying Like a Cam.
Hey, and if you must buy one of these buns, divide it up and share it with someone. As long as you're honest with your portions and count your cards, the rest is up to you. But remember, you're shopping for smaller clothes, not larger.
Richard is part, like, I don't know, he's a wonderful man who loves you, and part, like, but he still has the energy of, like, a disapproving mom.
We're having fun. Here it is already day 133, and it's time once again to board our TWA airline.
He's, like, body shaming with sincere love.
Oh, by the way, TWA is our own private airline. It stands for Take Weight Away. Yes, today we're traveling to Scarsdale, New York to meet Penny Hine. Now, normally, I would pretty much tell you Penny's story and share parts of her letter with you. But Penny wrote me such a...
Hey, a five-month resub from Lunagazer.
...so well. I asked her permission...
Let's go. Tape, tape.
...me to read in her own words how she lost weight. So here goes. Now, please pay close attention because this lady...
Okay, I'm going to pay close attention.
...super head start today. Dear Richard... Last
this lady is really going to get you off to a head start today. I'm going to go make a cup of coffee while Richard is telling this important story.
If Cinderella really exists, then I truly must be her. I have gone from a size 24 at 260 pounds to a perfect size 10 at 168 pounds, and I'm still going strong. I have just 18 more pounds to reach my goal. I was so excited when my Deal a Meal arrived in the mail. It isn't just your program that helps me, but also your encouragement. You were like a big brother by my side, keeping me motivated, as you said, all the things I needed to hear to keep me going. For you to understand fully what I have been through, let me fill you in with a little background history about me. I was always overweight. By the time I was 10 years old, just in the sixth grade, I was the youngest person in town attending Weight Watcher meetings. They had no idea what to do with me because no child had ever joined before. I had tried every diet possible from pills to attending summer camps, but nothing could make me change my ways. I guess I just wasn't ready. I never allowed my true feelings to show. Everyone always thought I was so happy. Sure, I was friendly. I forever had a smile on my face, but no one suspected how miserable I was on the inside. Each passing year, I was gaining more weight, and it seemed nothing could stop me on my path of self-destruction. Looking back, it's as if I were rushing my life, never having to actually live or be part of my own existence. I just turned 27 years old, and already I have a master's degree, a professional diploma, and I hold 3 licenses, including one to be a principal. Last year, I was honored by Phi Delta Kappa as Outstanding Teacher of the Year. Impressive, huh? But achieving all those things took a lot of my time. I was always too busy with work or helping others reach their goals to concentrate on one of the most important goals of my own, to lose weight. This is where you enter the picture. I remember you on TV talking about success and how it was time to start taking care of yourself. It was as if you were really directly talking to me. When you mentioned those Cinderella stories, none could be more true than mine. Nothing ever fit in my life but now. Not only does the glass slipper fit, but everything else in my life fits as well. I'm still very shy, partially because I was always ashamed of how I looked. But now I'm like a high school kid going out for the first time and truly seeing the world. Doing the Sweat Into the Oldie tapes and your walking cassettes have been a big help to me. I was never a lazy person. I always tried to be active, even when I was fat. I felt that I had to prove something, that just because I was fat didn't mean I couldn't get around. And I got around pretty good, too, but it wasn't easy. But today, exercising is downright fun for me, and my body can take every bit of the workout without me feeling like I need to call a paramedic. For the first time in my life, I feel hope and see a real future for myself. I love teaching, and I will continue to do everything I can to encourage and inspire my students. But I know that I will also do everything I need to see my own dreams fulfilled too. Thank you, Richard, for giving me the courage to take control of my life. I feel like a beautiful butterfly that has just burst free from a suffocating cocoon. Thank you for reminding me that I'm not out here alone, but most of all, thank you for opening my eyes to the fact that I, Penny, had the will and the power within myself to succeed. What a transformation Penny has made. She is certainly one of the smartest and most educated young ladies I have ever met. For all those years growing up, she doubted herself when all she had to do was look at all the other accomplishments in her life, just to see how strong she really was. I think you'll have to agree with me, those fifth graders at her elementary school in Scarsdale were some of the luckiest kids in the world to have Miss Hines as their teacher. And we're all lucky to have Miss Hines to teach us a thing or two. Today, I want you to take a look at your own life. We all have accomplishments to be proud of. It's time to stop doubting and start trusting yourself for the strength I know you have inside. There's a lot more glass slippers waiting in our special shoe store, and I promise you, there's one that will fit you perfectly. Until next time, make this one a super positive day. It's word day, and I think I've come up with a word that you probably never, ever even thought about using before. Today's word is accolade. Was I right? Do you use that word much in your everyday speaking? Do you know what it means? Well, let's see what my trusty dictionary has to say about accolade. Here it is. Accolade, an expression of approval, praise, special acknowledgement, an award. Actually, these are the modern day definitions for this word. As I was searching for the history of the word accolade, I discovered that it had origins in Latin and also French. Originally, accolade was used in reference to an embrace. In Old English times, an embrace was given to a knight when he was dubbed. So when King Arthur said, "I hereby dub you Sir Lancelot," well, he probably gave him a big hug. So technically, an accolade was really the ceremonial bestowal of knighthood, which was a great honor in those times. An accolade was the form of praise. And if you were accoladed in the olden days, well, you were really something. Nowadays, knighthood is still an honor given in England, but the word accolade has a much greater use in our modern day vocabulary. Think of it this way. If someone says to you, "Great job," well, that's an accolade. They are praising your accomplishments. How about the expression, "A job well done"? There's another accolade. It's a praise, a way of recognizing when someone has done something that's outstanding. As human beings, we love to be praised. In fact, we need praise. It's a necessity in today's terms. Praise is also called positive reinforcement. Children need positive reinforcement from their parents. That's because it's the only way for children to know that they are progressing in the right direction. As adults, we need praise or positive reinforcement just like when we were children. We need to know that we are doing a good job at work. That's why we get raises. When we receive a compliment, we are being given an accolade or praise. When we give compliments, we are giving accolades to someone else. Remember that famous line by Billy Crystal? "Darling, you look marvelous." We all love to hear that. Receiving praise or accolades for our weight loss accomplishments is one of the best ways to help us continue on our road to success. We all need to hear how good
Don't
we look.
Don't tell Richard I got... This is going to be so many bread cards. I ate a croissant and now I'm eating an apple turnover. Because I didn't have time for breakfast, so I'm just eating pastries.
Most importantly, don't be afraid to praise yourself for your
job. Starry job B. It's beautiful.
So you deserve to give yourself a pat on the back every once in a while. Giving yourself positive reinforcement for your own success will be a big boost to your morale.
Yeah, it's a fruit card.
Just be careful that in praising yourself, you don't try to reward yourself with food.
Also,
I can't tell you how many times I've heard from
5 month read sub from Rebel Tech TV who says, "Preach, Richard, preach indeed."
That they go out and reward themselves with a double.
And a 2 month resub from Colton KP. Thank you, Colton.
If you want to reward yourself for your successes, then treat yourself to some new clothes or buy yourself that special little something that you've wanted. Or
also, I forgot I don't have any coffee beans, so I had to use this.
Don't go back 2 steps.
This is Mackinac Island Fudge. Pre-ground coffee from a little packet that Lindsay brought when she stayed with us in October.
Special accolade.
It smells like coffee. It doesn't smell like coffee. It smells like chocolate.
I know
it's Mackinac? Oh, God.
And frustrating.
I'm not from...
Disappointing, but you have
that's in, like, Michigan, right? In the UP?
And the bad times. And I
or
know
something?
You are committed to seeing this through to its completion.
Oh, my God. It's a perfect Waffle House.
But I confer upon you this special seal, this special award for all the achievements and triumphs you've realized so far. You have come a long way with many more days ahead of you, but you have succeeded with grace, style, and dignity. You, my friend, are the very best.
Aw. Okay, we'll watch one more day of this.
Oh, how many times have you ever said to yourself, "Oy, my aching back"? You know, back pain seems to be one of the most common complaints of most people I know, but especially people who are overweight.
That's great.
And you know, carrying around extra weight puts an enormous amount of pressure on the lower spine.
Okay, well, this coffee, like, even the grounds, you know, even as I was brewing it, even sniffing it now, it just smells like chocolate.
Well, if you've got extra weight on you, the tendency will be for it to shift down and put extra pressure on your spine.
That's causing that fine. That's good.
Syndrome. Well, now that you've been following the deal a meal and losing
weight, it doesn't taste like a cup of coffee, but...
You shouldn't have as much pressure being put on your lower spine as before. But after a long day, you still may be suffering with back pain that really can be annoying. So today, I want to give you some tips on how to reduce the pain you may have in your lower back. One of the best ways to help you avoid lower back problems is to have firm...
I appreciate that very much, Haley.
These muscles...
But instant coffee is bad.
The abs are located here. They're your tummy... muscles on how to reduce the pain you may have in your lower back. One of the best ways to help you avoid lower back problems is to have firm stomach muscles. These muscles, also called the abs, are located here. They're your tummy.
Sorry.
Now, I'm sure you've seen those muscles on bodybuilders. You know how they are defined and seemed almost rippled.
Oh, okay, Haley. Do you not like the oils?
But firm,
you got to get the oils.
Muscles not only make you look better, they can also reduce your lower back pain. Here's why. If you have weak and out-of-shape stomach muscles, then your internal organs move out of place and there is a shift in the center of gravity. And since gravity pulls things down, there is greater stress placed on your spine. Not only does your back hurt, but you also develop a very unattractive bulge in this area, your lower stomach. That's the real battle of the bulge, believe me. Gravity is a tough thing to fight, and it requires a regular routine of exercise to keep your stomach muscles in shape. Now, if you've ever gone to a health club, you've probably seen this equipment that helps you to work out your stomach muscles. These machines allow you to do an exercise called the abdominal crunch, where you are working out the stomach muscles.
Sorry, sometimes I forget how my own commands work.
Lifting some weights. If you faithfully work out on these machines, you will notice that you can increase the amount of weight you can lift over a period of time. Not only will your stomach muscles get in shape, but you are also strengthening your lower back as you increase the amount of weight you are lifting. Well, since not everyone goes to a health club, there is an exercise you can do right at home to get your ab muscles in shape. These are called sit-ups, and you can do this type of exercise at any time. So maybe on a day when you're not doing your sweating to the oldies, you can take some time and work on your stomach and your lower back. Okay.
It made him into a European manly bro.
Like this. Bend your knees and make sure your feet are flat on the floor. Lightly place your hands behind your head. Don't interlace your fingers. Just sort of rest the back of your head in your hands. Now, lift your head, neck, and shoulders, and your torso in one motion. Focus on raising your shoulders and upper back off the ground so your shoulder blades clear the floor. Hold that position, then slowly lower to the floor and repeat. When you do this exercise, you will feel the crunch in your ab area, your stomach area. If you haven't really worked on this area before, you will find this exercise a little difficult to do in the beginning. Just keep working and do it slowly. Remember, when you do this exercise, use nice, slow, even movements. Don't pull up or off on the floor too fast. You don't want to strain your back in any way. For this exercise to be really effective, I recommend that you work up to doing 3 sets of about 15 repetitions each set. If you work on a regular basis, you will see some very impressive results. You'll feel those muscles tighten up and your midsection will take on a smoother form and definition. As you continue to work on your stomach muscles, you'll notice that the ache and pain...
Okay, thank you for bearing with me while I eat pastries.
Because as you strengthen and tone your abdominals, there is less pressure in a downward motion causing strain on your spine. So even though this kind of crunch isn't nearly as appealing as the chocolate candy bar crunch, if you practice enough, I know you'll be much healthier and see great results.
Are we going to,
Well, it's gonna get dark soon.
Are we gonna watch something else? Let's watch something else. That was Richard Simmons, everybody. Oh, he's doing the tongue, because it's Gene Simmons. Oh, I love the bread people. I love them so much. Cool. Let's figure out something. Great Escapes of World War II. Little Lulu from Unicorn Video. Complete bicycle maintenance and overhaul. Stop me if you see something you want to watch. Eyewitness Fish. Shirley Temple, 1 hour. Book of Virtues, which will get the VOD blocked. Eyewitness... Oh, okay. Well, let's do this. Let's poll. Let's do a poll for... Eyewitness. Fish. Bird. 1 minute. Start. Get your votes in now. Will it be fish or will it be bird? Ooh, it's a close one. No, it's not. Fish is winning now. Okay, it's going to be fish. There's no way it's bird. If it's bird, I'll eat my hat. So I'm going to go get fish. That was impressive that you tied it up. Luckily, I still have a vote. So I voted for fish at the last second. It's important to retain your tiebreaker vote so you can snipe it at the end. Eyewitness fish. Let's check it out. Let's see. Eyewitness fish sent in by Green Day Rock. Thank you, Green Day. Based on the Revolutionary Book Series. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Virtual Museum. This is from 1994, so I think it's from the first series as well. The one that's a little, like, unsure of itself, stylistically. Fish. Why is the fish a god in some cultures? Which prehistoric monster fish is still alive? I know that from Animal Crossing. Dive into the waters of the world and discover the most exotic creatures in nature. Take the plunge from dazzling coral reefs to the darkest depths to meet fish, a vast and varied group of animals much closer to humankind than you might imagine. Okay, I don't know about that. Are fish really that similar to humans? They're like as evolutionarily distinct as you can get without going into like bugs. Did fish come before bugs? Yes. Aquatic life was the first life, at least. All right, let's watch the fish. It has been rewound. Fish car. Ooh. I could see a fish Peter Gabriel stepping out of that car in a pimp outfit. Eyewitness fish. Here we go. Of course, Chaz. Of course. An anal. Yeah. He jumping. Yeah. Oh, it worked. Oh, dear. Beautiful. There's not an actual taxonomic classification for fish, which makes... which has made deciding whether something is okay to eat during Lent as a Catholic throughout the centuries a very contentious question. Greater than our own, and yet we hardly know it. You can eat a platypus on Friday, because that's technically a fish.
vast, strange, and spectacular, with
bite.
Creatures more
Aww.
Extraordinary and far more varied than any on land.
Yeah, this is early Eyewitness.
Masters of three quarters of the planet, with more species than all birds, reptiles, amphibians, and mammals.
Because not only is the like presentations, the filmmaking kind of different, like it hasn't found its voice yet, it seems like Martin Sheen hasn't found like the right register, that he hasn't like locked into the Eyewitness voice.
By Pisces, the symbol of rebirth and regeneration, the sign that completes the circle of the zodiac, perhaps because of the life cycle of this fish. The salmon, the king of fish, unmatched in agility.
The tastiest fish in the world.
In memory, stamina, and intelligence, the salmon is the adventurer of the deep. For its life is an epic journey. From its birth high up in a shallow stream, the salmon swims...
Okay, that's... Marlon Brando crossed with Mr. Bean.
And into the wide ocean, across many waters and habitats.
That's not Martin Sheen, that's Marlon Bean.
To the very place of its birth. And where the salmon goes, people follow. For over 8,000 years, this fish was the main source of food for native tribes living along the rivers of the northwest coast of America. They built their lives around the salmon and its journey, and their descendants still call themselves the Salmon People. 500 million years ago...
It's a pretty good Martin Sheen, like young Martin Sheen.
No fins, no scales, but they did possess one revolutionary feature, a strong...
Benito. Oh, he's like a little pea pod.
The spine.
I love it.
A feature so important that without it, there would be no birds, no reptiles, mammals, or humans.
Hey, tape. Thank you, Tom Coat, for the 5-month resub.
Evolution moved forward. Fins grew for steering. Some fish developed a skeleton of soft cartilage, which led to the shark and the ray. Most formed scales for protection, a swim bladder,
Sunny Fenny.
And a skeleton of hard bone. For the last 100 million years, this design has been the prototype of almost every fish, including the most famous fish fossil of all, the coelacanth, thought to have died out at least 80 million years ago. But then in 1938,
Sparky.
Scientists were stunned to find the coelacanth was alive and well, living off the east coast of Africa. The only people who weren't surprised were local fishermen, who for years had used the coarse skin of the coelacanth as a roughening tool when patching the inner tubes of their bicycles. For its first few months, the young salmon stays in the stream, growing and gaining strength. But then, when it's still only 4 inches long and weighing just a few ounces, comes the irresistible urge to find the sea. The fish head downstream in schools or shoals, traveling up to 5 miles a day. Every part of the fish's body and every sense is geared to one aim.
We did our taxes, yes. Our taxes have been filed.
Diversifying into nearly 30,000 species. Many have vast egg-laying powers. The
Spike.
Ocean sunfish can lay 300 million eggs at one time.
I like his little fish leg.
And we acknowledge this abundance with encouraging words. At times when love breaks down.
The worst part about doing your taxes is putting in one, like,
and indeed,
using
from the small
shitty tax filing software that costs too much money, because I'm an idiot and should just do the free thing, but I use TaxSlayer for some reason.
Feet long, weighing twice as much as the biggest.
The worst part is when you put your form, one of the forms,
1 trillion herring,
like, you put in your W-2 from your job where you withheld way too much, and then you're like, my rebate's gonna be 10 grand. And then you put in form after form of other stuff, other income, and then it gradually shrinks to nothing.
So what makes a fish? Despite their variety, most share the same basic features, a bony skeleton supported on the spine.
Oh, we should have a VHS tape about doing your taxes. The closest we got was the bowling tape that told us to get a CPA.
For fine movement and steering, and to breathe, Fish use gills, which suck in water and pass it over a tightly folded surface rich with blood vessels, 10 times as big as the entire area of the fish's skin. Fish also have a unique organ, the lateral line, running the length of the body on either side. A special tube filled with fluid and jelly feels tiny changes in water movement and pressure so that the fish instantly senses its surroundings. All fish possess external protection, scales.
Oh.
Transparent plates made
thin again
for strength, overlapping for flexibility.
I don't know what's going on there. It's fine.
Copied by some for protection. And copied by others for style. Most fish swim with an S wriggle. It begins with a tiny sideways motion of the head, growing as it sweeps along the body, pushing the surrounding water sideways and backwards. So the fish has to move forward. With a shape so sleek, it's been imitated wherever aerodynamics are an essential.
They clearly designed the Saturn V rocket to look like a fish.
Cover the spectrum. There is no known color which is not found on the body of a fish.
Yeah, why hasn't NASA made a rocket that just wiggles back and forth to get into space?
So much in size from hatched young.
If it wiggles side to side, that means the only way it can go is up.
In bulk, from a dwarf pygmy goby the length of a thumbtack to a whale shark that could block an entire 6-lane freeway. Or ranges so widely in speed, from a seahorse with a weak dorsal fin that weaves it along at a mere 50 feet in an hour, to the sailfish, faster than any land animal, capable of speeds of over 60 miles per hour.
It was a nice stereo pan.
That divides all fish into two clear and different groups, the barrier between river and sea, between fresh water and salt water. Few fish can cross that barrier, but the salmon is one.
Oh my God, is the Eyewitness Museum underwater right now?
Freshwater fish of the river.
I guess it is.
To a saltwater fish of the sea. Now about a year old and weighing less than a pound, the young salmon brave the vast ocean. In all fish, the driving force is survival, to eat and not be eaten. There is food almost everywhere in the sea, from plankton to rocks. The parrotfish, with a large crushing beak, actually grinds up pieces of coral containing tiny algae and marine animals, finally excreting the unwanted powder in a plume of sand. For every attack, there is a defense. And for every defense, an attack. While the
don't eat spiky boy.
For its catch, others fool for it. And the scorpion fish has the most deadly spines of any fish, strong and sharp enough to pierce the sole of a shoe, and a poison that can kill a person within hours.
That is.
Some feel for their.
That is a weird fish, and I don't like it.
Some actually fish for it. And some fall for it. The
so fast.
Opening down hole has led to stories of sailors like Jonah being swallowed by creatures of the deep. While people have no trick to avoid being eaten, fish have devised unique ways to avoid ending up on the predator's plate. The puffer fish can swallow water and puff itself into a huge ball on demand, turning it from a tasty morsel.
Oh, it's like trying to eat a very large cardboard tube. It's so cute.
But the most successful form of defense and attack is nature's great game of deception, camouflage.
She really is a land eel.
The startling razorfish hides among the weeds. And many other open water fish are double camouflaged, taking on the tones of their surroundings from above and below. Humans have also learned the benefits of disguise. For the early Christians, this was a way to avoid persecution and death. They used codes and signs to recognize each other, and their secret symbol was the fish. They chose the fish because in Greek, the initial letters of the phrase Jesus Christ, Son of God, the Savior, spell out fish. Now the salmon is also camouflaged for open water, and as it feeds and grows, its strength will enable it to swim far across the ocean. Others seem less gifted, yet have their own tricks. The Amazon leaffish is perfectly disguised, playing dead among the leaves floating in the water until its prey comes within range. The blenny retreats into a hiding place. And when it sees a threat, the garden eel just isn't there.
Whoop. Nope.
Some rely on the defenses of others to protect themselves, like the cardinal fish, which hides among the poisonous spines of sea urchins. In many cultures, even humans have received protection from fish. In Hinduism, Matsya, the fish god, saved Manu,
fish
the
savior.
First man, by warning him of the coming flood and advising him to build a boat loaded with the seed of all things. Then the god towed Manu and the boat to safety.
A boat full of the seed of all things would probably smell pretty bad.
Over territory guarantee the species will be spread out, ensuring food for all. These fights can be dangerous, sometimes fatal, but even when strength is ill-matched, it is the intruder who is most often driven off. Sometimes the survival battle is against the environment. The ice fish contains no blood, but instead a transparent plasma with its own antifreeze to keep it alive in water so cold that any other fish would die in seconds. And at the other extreme, tilapia survive where no other creatures can, in the searing heat of volcanic soda lakes. But surely the most alien fish are far beyond human eyes in the vast depths. The ocean's deepest trough goes down 7 miles, almost 1.5 times the height of Mount Everest, with a pressure that would crush most fish instantly. How can any creature possibly survive down here? These fish have a feather-like skeleton and a body completely devoid of air. At such depths, they spend their entire lives in eternal darkness. To compensate, many of these remote fish actually create their own light using organs with a luminous mucus, eyes or teeth, or in the case of the lantern jaw, the tongue. Some
bubbles.
Even have a luminous flap dangling inside the mouth, which they open to draw in prey. Others have luminous bacteria hidden under a flap of skin to be flashed occasionally. It is surely the strangeness of these creatures which has caught the imagination of man, uncannily calling forth his most primal fears.
Oh, that one's a... That one's a little lewd.
Small wonder that for centuries, sailors returned home with fish stories of a different kind. Sea monsters formidable enough to swallow a ship, frightful enough to drive sailors mad, and fascinating enough, like the fetching mermaid, to bewitch and beguile, apparitions to be treated with respect, most of the time.
Oh, how we love to own a store, that's all we wish for, a lovely fish store. We have the mermaids, all the fish and the dolly.
But to prove truth is...
God damn it, it just...
...the flatfish. At 2 weeks...
No, nothing in it.
...place and all flatfish...
What's wrong with the skin? Sorry, Swift. I'm...
The right eye moves to the center, and then over the front of the skull to the other side. At the same time, the fish begins to swim on its side. A week later, both eyes are on the top of the head, and only its mouth shows it once swam upright. In the next few days, the upper side of its body will take on the color...
Stand back!
After 7 weeks, it is a perfectly camouflaged flatfish. Out in the ocean, the salmon has also changed. 2 years old and growing fast, its body is a mass of muscle. It now feeds on...
Good enough.
...and small fish.
Good enough.
Indeed, a diet of shrimp has turned the flesh of this shoal into the familiar salmon pink, so prized by chefs and gourmets and other hungry predators. The shoal, like the beehive on land, the supreme underwater community.
Shrimpy, that's just a shrimp.
It leads the individuals to food-rich waters, and some find mates within the shoal.
Ooh, sushi waffles.
The security of marrying the fish next door. And most of all, the shoal offers a valuable defense, safety in numbers. A predator needs to select a single target.
Ooh, that's an Elden Ring character.
Impossible.
At his little armies.
And a dense shoal moving in unison can appear as a single, much larger creature, each fish using its lateral lines to feel the movement of the shoal and respond instantly. The ultimate synchronized swimmers.
We love Finnegan.
So how do fish work in such close harmony? How good are fish senses? Many fish have amazing eyesight, spotting the distinctive markings of their own kind. Some even have eyes which can see both below and above the water. While the archer fish has such extraordinary eyesight, it can spot a fly on a leaf above and then fire a deadly accurate jet of water to knock the fly off its perch.
He just spits on his prey.
Fish have their own form of hearing. A fish's inner ear feels pressure waves from water movement in the same way that our ears sense what is going on in three dimensions around us. And it is this which enables the fish to orient itself. The dottyback, feeding on the underside of the reef, doesn't care that it is upside down. That just makes it easier to find food. Some fish also have senses we don't possess. Some eels navigate by use of electricity, using the 6,000 electric cells on their body to send out small shock waves and feel their surroundings.
Ooh, I wanna,
with a power surge of 500 volts.
I'm gonna grill that eel.
Outright. But fish do have one talent in common with us. They can talk, often at high frequency and inaudible to us, but the fish's world is alive with sound. The Garibaldi fish clicks like a metronome to attract a mate. And when confronted by unwelcome advances, the female cichlid knows how to say no. While the brooding sergeant major fish squeaks like a mouse to ward off intruders. Fish make sounds all the time to mate, navigate, threaten, and cooperate. Indeed, fish often form partnerships where the gain is mutual. The sea anemone is home to families of clownfish who produce a special mucus to protect themselves against the poisonous tentacles while they feed on the remains of the anemone's victims. And the 8-foot grouper is host to tiny cleaner wrasse, even in its mouth. The grouper gets a dental cleaning, and the wrasse gets a free meal. On the reef, other fish gather at cleaning stations to be attended by the wrasse. It even advertises its service with a kind of calling card dance. But one of the strangest partnerships of all is that of the goby and a shrimp. The alpheid shrimp is a prodigious digger of tunnels, but has very poor eyesight and cannot see danger or find its way home when it goes in search of food. The goby also likes to live in tunnels. It can't dig them, but it does have...
I want to try that a couple more times.
So the two of them set up home together. The goby stands guard at the tunnel entrance, alert for any danger, while the shrimp collects food and keeps the tunnel clear. Most of the time, she keeps in touch with the goby with her long antennae.
Trier and cuprate.
If the shrimp strays too far from the tunnel entrance, the goby goes off to find her, makes contact, and shepherds her home again.
How the species Atoyan knows the Ahikis tape. Okay.
For humans, the main value of fish has always been as a source of food. The sturgeon provides the most expensive food in the world, beluga caviar. This delicacy of fish eggs is so valuable that folk songs were written about one sturgeon that contained 323 pounds of caviar. We have created a host of superstitions around fish. Many fishing communities believe that fish possess special powers of good or ill fortune. The first salmon caught is unlucky and must be returned to the sea. Tench applied to the feet is a cure for jaundice. Beer in which a fish is drowned is a cure for whooping cough. Though bad news for the fish. But traditionally, the salmon has been the bearer of good news. In Wales, one rather saucy salmon was said to rise to the surface and wink naughtily at married women. After 2 to 6 years traveling the sea,
what?
The salmon now feels the urge to return home, to the stream where it was born. It crosses hundreds of miles of ocean using only its homing instinct and a powerful sense of smell to find that one particular river. Reaching the river, the salmon's body has to readapt to the fresh water. It waits, quietly now, for this last transformation to be complete. Some fish are already finding mates and pairing off, and so the final leg of the journey begins. In other waters, countless...
Yeah, I think it was part, like, VHS camcorder, part...
...of color and display.
Bazooka.
Most fish reproduce by laying eggs fertilized outside the body in the water. For many species, these fertilized eggs are simply left to the mercy of the currents and hungry predators. Some make nests for their eggs, fiercely guarding their young.
The forehead fish. Oh, that's so many fish eggs. Look at them swarm.
And some fish go to extremes to protect their babies. This mouth brooder isn't eating her young, but sheltering them in her mouth as danger threatens. Occasionally, the roles of parents are reversed. For the seahorse, it's the male which rears its young, fertilizing and storing the eggs in a pouch in the front of his body until the baby seahorses are old enough to be released.
TOS.
As with any child,
seahorse hole,
which keeps the young close to the parent, it is also the sense of smell which guides the salmon back to its spawning ground. Not once pausing to eat, the salmon steadily loses strength as it swims upstream. Many will die. As the urge to breed gets stronger, the fish battles to conquer any obstacle, to leap any barrier. It has no fear of hurling itself clear of the water, in its frenzy risking its own life. But there are less dangerous fish out of water stories. Mudskippers love to play on land, using their fins as tiny legs, chasing each other across mud flats and catching insects. Walking catfish can stay out of water for up to 12 hours, covering over half a mile on land. The tiny but powerful hatchet fish of the Amazon will even leap from the water and fly to escape a predator. While the Amazon arowana will leap higher than a man to catch its prey. But none of these can match the salmon in power as it fights its way upstream, evading predators as it goes.
Leg fish. I love leg fish.
The salmon has completed its journey and now will breed, the female digging out a hollow where the two travelers lie together. Of the 3,000 to 5,000 eggs originally laid, only one or two salmon will complete the marathon journey back to their breeding grounds. After spawning, many of these adults will drift exhausted downstream to die. But their eggs will hatch, and the life cycle begins anew. Like Pisces, rebirth. The fish echoes our own birth, our earliest living ancestor, ruler of a world greater than our own, and still far beyond our reach.
Bill Butt! Thank you, Bill Butt! Your name is Butt. All right. Do we get a making of on this one? Do we not get a making of on this one? Wild. Okay. Well, there was nothing special that they wanted to highlight about the fish tape. This is season one, but they have we got a making of on Eyewitness Dinosaur. All right. Oh, there is. I fast-forwarded a little bit.
The Eyewitness Museum, created by combining traditional filmmaking techniques with state-of-the-art graphics, stripping away the mysteries of nature and science to reveal the essence of each subject.
I love that little fish.
Bringing the world into sharp focus.
That's really good.
The making of Eyewitness. The distinct style of the Eyewitness books is...
I love down-tempo Eyewitness theme.
Each half-hour episode is based on a book title. The Eyewitness book's visual style gives the program makers a starting point and a challenge. The challenge of transferring the clarity and super realism into moving images and sound. Now let's take a look behind the scenes at the making of fish. In fish,
the making of fish.
The salmon as our central animal. Our biggest challenge on the program was how to photograph underwater creatures against a clean white background, isolating them from their surroundings and bringing them into sharp focus. We began filming on a salmon farm in Wales. First of all, we needed the backgrounds of rushing water. This was easily obtained with an underwater camera on the end of a stick. To photograph the fish, we set up a huge flow tank to create a current in which the fish could swim.
I mean, they're based in, I would assume, London, so.
Good, but far from perfect.
Wales is probably the easiest place to find a salmon farm.
A completely new approach was needed. After much agonizing, we decided to bring the fish to the Eyewitness studio. We built a donut-shaped tank in the studio, made of metal, with one section of glass for filming the fish.
This is really elaborate.
One concern was to keep the water and the glass clean to obtain the best possible photographs of the fish.
And to keep the fish from swimming into those fan blades. Like, you have to build a whole aquarium.
At the moment of truth, filling the tank, we found that plumbing was not our strong point. But we were uncertain whether the fish would be happy in the flow tank. To our delight, the first fish dropped into the tank immediately began to swim against the current and was obviously satisfied with our efforts. Now it was time for a bigger challenge. A larger salmon was dropped into the tank.
She's much kinder.
After some acclimatization, the large salmon also seemed content. The success of filming relied totally on adjusting the flow of water around the tank so that the fish were comfortable swimming against the current. If the flow was too slow, the fish would bunch up at the front of the filming tank. If it was too fast, they would stay at the back.
I mean, it's really wild.
A perfect shot of a fish against
like
blue.
The effort they went to.
One fish can become many fish, and blue can become white. We had fun explaining the motion of a fish through water. With a little help from the director, our model could soon demonstrate the perfect S wriggle. The fish, of course, don't need a director.
Yeah, Dinosaur was like, we just got a bunch of action figures and filmed them. Eyewitness Pegasus. Eyewitness sharks flying out of a volcano. Ooh, Eyewitness Skeleton looks good. We do have that one now. I gotta add it to the website. Eyewitness kissing things that turn you into an old hag. Eyewitness camel. Or elephant. Whew. Eyewitness Skeleton is a good idea for Halloween. A fashion show with fish. All right, well, thank you for watching that one with us. That's Eyewitness Fish. I was looking at some of the more favorited tapes to see if there was a good one that we could put on for a little while. And I was thinking we either have advanced note-taking, a dynamic keyword approach with this man, or There is also Sewing with Nancy, Super Quick Knits. Between the All, that's so sweet. Well, it's a little late for the kind unkind prediction. But yeah, I guess Bella isn't here. Bella is usually the one running those. Eyewitness Fish. Okay. Advanced note taking or Nancy? I will make a poll. Haley, are you interested in Nancy? The world wants to know. Video of the month, free transcript with purchase. Oh, you can vote in polls on Android now? That's spectacular. It looks like Nancy is winning. Yeah, if you want, Haley. Okay, I'll get Nancy. Yeah, my mom loved sewing with Nancy. I've mentioned it before. But we had all these, growing up in our home, we all had like a collection of VHS tapes that we would use to record stuff off the TV. And chances are, if you recorded something that you really wanted to keep, eventually it would get taped over with Sewing with Nancy. Sewing with Nancy, super quick knits. It's an attractive cassette. A video for contemporary sewers. Oh, they're using the term sewer in 1988 instead of seamstress. Super quick knits. Nancy Zeman, host of TV's Sewing with Nancy, brings her three-part series on super quick knits to you in this 60-minute video. Highlights. Layout, cutting, and stitching with conventional machines or sergers, applying ruffled elastic, creating fast and easy knit scar. Ooh, we get scarves. Sewing a reversible top with two layers of interlock, adding a ribbed accent, sewing a quick interlock skirt. Reference material. To accompany this video, Nancy has written a fully illustrated transcript titled Super Quick Knits, which is not in here, but that's okay. Copyright 1988, Nancy's Notions Limited, Beaver Dam, Wisconsin. I forgot she was... Nancy's from Wisconsin, right? Okay. I don't know that much about sewing. I mean, I've absorbed quite a lot about it over the years, but I'm not a... I don't sew myself. But I feel like this will be just a chill hour of Nancy. Oh, it's the dog.
This is not the snack part, but there you go.
Thank you.
Oh, she's been trying so hard to be polite.
Yes, of course. The dog is eating crumbs.
Welcome.
She's very cute.
With Nancy, with your host, Nancy Zeman. This educational videotape is being brought to you by Pfaff, the largest European producer of sewing machines. Pfaff, simply the best. By Pella, the first name in interfacing and innovative sewing aids.
This is great. This is some vintage 1988. It's sponsored by Pfaff. My mom sold Pfaff sewing machines.
By Ginger, a tradition of quality in scissors and shears for home, classroom, and industry. The McCall Pattern Company, the most fashionable name in contemporary home sewing patterns, and publishers of McCall's Patterns, sewing's fashion magazine. And by Nancy's Notions Sewing Catalog, featuring specialty sewing books and unique, hard-to-find sewing notions and supplies.
Welcome to Sewing with Nancy and to our series on super quick knits. In this series, we're going to be sewing and serging knits to make them look
you
like
do match.
Or better yet, with our professional touch. So often today, the modular or component type of knits are very popular and ready to wear. Well, we can
thank you.
The same
thank you.
By sewing them, probably at a fourth of a cost and just in an evening or two of time. We're going to be working with interlocks and jerseys and choosing some colors that may go well together so that you can mix and match.
I love this assortment of colors.
Renee is modeling some of our
options. It's very 1988. Oh, my God.
Some garments together. With a simple jacket, top, and skirt, you have one look. And then by adding a simple cowl neck and sash, you have another. Or it could simply be just a tunic with a different sash. Or combining a skirt with a tunic top. And of course, another sash. But don't forget the pants, because they're an endless option too of making modular knits look great together. So that's what our program is going to be about using knits, but then combining them together with specific sewing techniques to make this a fun way of sewing and a fun way of dressing. I'll get set up at the sewing table right now to begin.
Knit identification. God, I love these graphics so much.
When preparing this program on super quick knits, I use basically two types of fabrics, knit fabrics that is, of interlock and jersey. First of all, the interlock. The interlock is a 1x1 rib. It's a double knit. And from this illustration, you can get an idea of how the knit construction has been made. Because of the double knit form, it looks the same on the right side as it does on the wrong side, making it very versatile. It also has a lot of stretch, about 50% stretch.
Hi, Bella. It's good to be back.
Fabric
good to have you back.
A ribbing trim, or of course you could buy ribbing, but this makes it a nice and versatile this way. 100% cotton interlocks are many times suggested. They're nice because they do not pill or cling as much, but on the other hand, they're a little bit more expensive.
And God, Nancy's shoulders and sleeves are so huge. I love them.
This is the 50-50, the 50 polyester, the 50 cotton interlock, which I've used on many of the samples today. It isn't quite as expensive, comes in a great color range, and still does have to be pre-treated for shrinkage. When pre-washing or treating the interlock, treat it as if it were soiled. On the cotton interlock, you may want to pre-wash it twice to combat the yarns and also to prevent later shrinkage. Now for the jersey. The jersey comes in wool, blends, as well as 100% cotton. Many times we think of jersey as t-shirt knit. Here you can see how jerseys are made. They're smooth on one side and have horizontal loops on the other.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, Bella.
Right from the wrong side. You can look at the loops.
We started 5 minutes late because I had to go pick the dog up from the dog sitter.
Right side. So that's how you can tell the right side of this fabric.
This is a really great photo of Nancy.
These are types of fabrics were not used in when I prepared this program on super quick knits. They're just a little bit too lightweight for the fashions that we're showing today. But the wool jersey, on the other hand...
I really hate it when photographers tell you to do that thing, to put your fist under your chin.
Have the dry cleaner steam your wool jersey.
And tilt your head at precisely the right angle.
Shrinkage, as well as the sizing. Because if the sizing is left in the fabric, many times that will cause skipping of stitches. And we all know how aggravating that can be. So after you've pre-treated your fabric, then layout is necessary.
Oh, Nancy died in 2017.
Many of these knit fashions that we're working with in this series are very simple, which makes it...
Wild. Great.
Because the pattern pieces are not that many, and so we can simply streamline our layout and cutting. Now, after pre-washing the fabric, you may find that the center fold of the fabric will not come out.
I did not know.
Usually it will not. So if you have to lay the fabrics on a fold, please refold the fabric to avoid using this in your garment. But in this little pair of shorts, you can see that I would have to avoid this or could easily avoid that. Also, for interlock or jersey, one-way layout. In other words, make one.
My mom loved sewing with Nancy, and
could be a slight
when I was growing up, and then later on,
like so one-way layout.
My mom
for ease of cutting,
ran a sewing machine store in her later life. That was her career, and she sold Pfaffen baby lock sewing machines.
Super sharp scissors,
and she went to these conventions, and she ended up meeting Nancy and hanging out with her a bunch.
Quickly sew knits. I'm going
so that's my mom with Nancy at a baby luck conference in 2003.
Knit fabrics. These fabrics are easy to sew, but ready-to-wear has even made them faster to sew. And we're going to borrow some of these techniques. For example, eliminating the facings. On this garment, the facing seam allowance was simply pressed to the wrong side. And then zigzagged or top.
So yeah, my mom died in 2017 of a type of blood cancer, and Nancy Zeman died in 2017 of a type of bone cancer.
Sample of a contrasting thread where you can see after the
not so fun facts.
Zigzagging stitches were done as an emphasis on either side. It's kind of a fun treatment, a little bit different than what we're accustomed to in our type of sewing. When sewing this type of way, of course, just using the 5/8 of an inch seam allowance, then set your machine for a zigzag, a medium width and a relatively medium stitch length, and zigzag on both sides of the stitching line. On modular knits or on interlocks, you may have to hold your threads a little bit for those first couple stitches, and then it's very simple. Simply zigzagging on either side. Notice I'm following the presser foot down the seam line area. After sewing one side, then simply just do the other side as well, and the seam is complete. The key when working with this type of sewing, kind of quick, unconventional sewing.
No, it was like 7 months apart.
Zigzag stitches I've used here, then follow it all the way through. Have the garment hemmed and faced with these same zigzag stitchings. Again, you can see that's a fast treatment. Now on the hem allowance and on the facing allowance, you may find that we have to do a little pressing first of all. And on this simple little sample along the facing, we've pressed under the seam allowance. Now you may notice that the seam allowance is not quite 5/8 of an inch. It's a little bit narrower. And the reason for that is I've trimmed off a 1/4 of an inch just because it was a little bit difficult to curve, press around this curve. So after pressing, then once again, on your completed garment, sew all the way around the neckline, just with this simple zigzag stitch, making certain, of course, not to stretch the fabric. It has been pressed into the right size, so just sew without stretching at all. And that is practically the fastest facing I've ever put on a garment. So I'll just continue to go around here. And then after working with the facings, then you could simply press up the hem and zigzag into place, and the garment basically would be completed. That's some super quick sewing, but now you may want to use your serger to do some of the same type of work. I'd like to show this to you on this other sample garment where we have some exposed seams. I chose on this sample to show the exposed seam using decorative thread in the facing area and also decorative thread in the shoulder seams. It doesn't have to be used throughout the garment, but just as a little emphasis. To sew this super quick seam, in my serger, I've set up for a 3-thread overlock stitch with a texturized nylon thread in all three positions. And now I'm going to sew this, serging so that my needle is sewing right on the 5/8 of an inch seam. And I have slightly tightened my stitches so that I have a very nice, dense stitch. Remember, this is going to
I like the close-up with the picture-in-picture.
Anyway, I'm sure many of you who have sergers have used this type of seam, this exposed seam, but to keep it from flopping around, to keep it nice and streamlined, the next step is to stitch this down, to stitch it straight. And on this sample, you can see that on the top side, just done some top stitching right along the very edge to keep it nice and flat. So it's a very clean type of seam and look. Now the same type of seam can be carried out through the facing area and pressing under the seam allowance and maybe trimming the seam allowance so that there isn't quite that bulk that you may experience. Then sew along the very edge of this with the same type of stitch. Now it works out great for interlocks because they are basically the same on both sides. So after sewing it on a serger, then simply move to your regular stitch and your straight stitch and stitch the facing down into place. The hem could also be worked in this same way by serging the very edge of the hem, pressing it up to the right side, and then of course you could simply top stitch it into place. So serge and top stitch. Next we'll do some flat locking techniques. Another decorative technique for knits that has a very nice flat seam is a flat lock. And here I've used top stitching thread in the upper looper for this decorative effect at the hem, but it also can be used in the seam allowance. Traditionally, flat locking is kind of a weak seam, but here we're going to combine it with some traditional straight stitching. On this sample, you'll see the standard 5/8 of an inch seam allowance has been sewn. Then after it has been pressed open, simply fold the fabric along the seam line. Just fold it along that seam line. I have my machine set up for a flat lock. Of course, check your owner's manual for the proper settings on your machine. And I'm using a blind hem foot on my serger so that
Stitcherella.
I'm guiding the fabric away from the blade. Or you can simply just guide it just a little bit from the blade.
Oh my God. Whoa. An anonymous gifter has given 20 community subs. Thank you.
Next we'll make some belts and sashes out of this.
Wow, thank you so much. Holy hell, that goes to Cross Poison, Fire Goddess, The Brax, Bountiful Ruby, Atom Attacks, Faelina, Randomness, HP 5, Knight Dap, Dave Barcourt, DC 20 Will Save, Damon Live 4, Wild Torterra, Goku 90, Magma Fish, Cuddling Searle, Aerith Stars, Konosuga Slayers, Movers, and Alien Soups. Wow, thank you, Anonymous. You are very kind.
Here Renee is wearing some of these sashes around her waistline, or they can simply be tied together in many different color combinations, or even worn around the neckline. They're just kind of
that
fun.
Deserves a Peter Gabriel, I guess. I need more alerts.
It may be necessary to finger press.
Yeah,
or
thank you all so much for your subscribating.
Under 1/2 inch, and my machine is set on a zigzag stitch. Now notice that I did not press under the corners. We're just going to do one side at a time. I'm going to put the fold of the fabric at the center of the foot. And a machine is set at a zigzag stitch so that one zigzag goes off the fabric, one goes into the fabric.
Hey, thank you, Bella, for a 5-month resub.
Sew one side, and then after sewing one side, do the trimming. Now, here you can see that the stitch is just a very little edge stitch. And of course, you try to do this in matching thread as opposed to contrasting. And then bevel your scissors, whether it's an applique scissors or a regular scissors.
Steam is very good.
It is flat against the fabric and trim away. With this applique scissors, I'm not going to cut the underneath fabric, but also by beveling it allows me to trim right next to the zigzag stitch. Then after stitching and trimming one side, press under another side and stitch and trim. And that's how this nice little edge finish has been put on some of the sashes. Now in a serger, of course, we can do this a little bit faster and simpler. But I have set my machine at a narrower width of a stitch, so that it isn't too wide. And it's really not necessary to do any of the extra trimming, because we'll just simply serge at the very edge. Serge like we were serging napkins. Serge one edge, fray check the ends, then serge the other. And this is simply how many of Renee's sashes were trimmed. Fast and fun accent for knits. Now we're going to do a little something that's a little bit more detailed on knit fabrics, and that's some elastic casings at the waist. Here Renee is modeling a very fashionable little skirt that has 3-inch wide elastic at the waist. This is now available to us from many companies, either 3 to 5 inches wide at the waist, where you see the elastic.
That's a good don't touch me.
A little ruffled edge at the top. This is kind of fun elastic.
She has 6 fingers on her left hand.
It's very strong elastic. It's kind of hard to stretch out, but it's fun to work with. Due to the width, we have to somewhat change the basic pattern piece. And to change the pattern, I'm going to show you the original pattern piece. Here you can see the natural waistline marking. You're going to trim off the excess fabric from the top, just allowing for the seam allowance. I'm going to sew this on the serger, and it has a 3/8 inch seam allowance, so I've measured 3/8 inch above the natural waistline marking and trimmed off the excess pattern tissue from this top. So that's a simple change that you can make. Obviously, if you can make this change before you do the cutting out, you can save yourself some fabric.
200 bits from Billabunny, Ghost of a Red Panda, learning how to use a sewing machine. Aw.
Quarter the fabric and pin the quarter
mark. Aw.
Sewing with the elastic on the top, we're going to stretch the elastic to meet the fabric. Again, this has a lot of stretch to it. I'm just going to serge this on a very flat piece of fabric so that you can see a little bit more clearly. But the trick will be when working with this is not to trim or cut away any of the elastic. So guide the fabric a little bit to the left of the needle. This is about the fastest elastic you can put on. I'll just anchor a few stitches and then stretch the elastic to meet the fabric. And again, I have my stitch set at relatively close together. And just
stretch
the fabric and sew. And just with one row of stitching, the whole waistline of your simple knit skirt has been placed right on there. On many of these elastics, one edge is ruffled. So this ruffled edge obviously becomes the top. And when I bring this up, you can see what a fast and fun elastic treatment that is. That's super quick. Now for another type of elastic that's very...
Oh, this mischievous red panda.
I think it's fun if we can create things like we see in ready-to-wear. And this is kind of a sport elastic. You'll see this both on knit and woven fabrics. Here's a little
sample. Oh, did we get a simultaneous bingo winner? Okay.
And the straight stitches have been stitched through the elastic. The elastic is somewhat exposed on the inside. This elastic, when you look in your fabric store, has special rows that have not been braided. They're a little bit loftier and fuzzier in about every
half. All right, I have given both of you points.
A row that hasn't been braided.
Congratulations.
This row is where the stitching is going to be sewn. It has been left unbraided so that, obviously, your needle will not cut the threads of the elastic, causing the elastic to fan out. In the past, if we tried to duplicate this type of look that is so frequently found in ready-to-wear, we couldn't do it because our needles would break the threads and then the elastic would lose its power of stretch. Now we have that change. Again, we have to look at the pattern just a little bit because the pattern has to be changed and cut down, a slight amount. It's best if you can refer to your pattern piece and again look at the natural waistline. On this particular pattern, it says across the top that 1 1/4 casing has been allowed. So I'm simply going to fold down, which I've already marked, 1 1/4 casing. I would like the top of my elastic to end right at the fold of this pattern. Here's where the elastic, when it's in the fabric, will end on the pattern. But if I turn this to the back side, you see this great casing amount. I do not need this total width of the casing.
You might have trouble with this friend.
I only need 1/2 inch. So I have a little mark here, marked it 1/2 inch. And with your scissors, simply trim off the excess fabric so that there's just 1/2 inch.
Willow, with a natural waistline.
We'll fold this back. And in this particular instance, I'm trimming away 5/8 inch. On each pattern, it may vary, but it's usually between 1/2 inch and 3/4 inch that you'll be trimming away. So now your waistline is correct on your fabric. And now for your elastic. When determining this elastic, cut it 3 to 5 inches smaller than your actual waistline. That seems quite small, I realize, but 3 to 5 inches smaller. The reason for this is that this elastic doesn't have quite as much stretch as you may think of other elastics. So we're going to stretch it out, and then after it elasticizes, it will fit you fine. It'll fit very comfortable. A hint may be, if you're not that expensive at an elastic, you may want to give a sample trial of this before you actually sew it. I have right
now
together, and I'm going to stitch down this first row that hasn't been braided, attaching the elastic to the garment.
It's white Bill Cosby. I don't want to look at him.
Sew down the
dish. Go away.
You could do this by serger, or you could simply do it as I'm doing now with a straight stitch.
Yeah, Nancy is the.
So part of this for you right now.
Nancy is the goat, the sewing goat.
Of putting the elastic to the garment.
As the kids say.
I'll now simply fold this to the wrong side, just folding it to the wrong side. And now it's necessary to do a lot of pinning, to pin this into place so that the elastic is flat to the
calling, referring to the sides of the knit fabric as the right side and the wrong side sounds really confusing.
Fabric and stitch in these rows, stitch in the ditches, starting at the bottom row.
Because what is the right side to fold it to? The right side to fold it to is the wrong side. No, no, no. You're folding it to the wrong side. You need to fold it to the right side, which is the wrong side.
Remaining 3 rows and keep on sewing. And after sewing row after row of this elastic with about 10 stitches per inch, then you have your elastic put into place. And it looks just like what you could buy at expensive ready-to-wear. We'll be back after this pause for our next part of our program. As you can see, you can really sew knits very quickly by using very simple seams, by obviously using a zigzag stitch or a serger. So it's a lot of fun and you can create a lot of different looks. But don't forget, of course, to use various types of elastic like they use in ready-to-wear. We can get the same type of look at the sewing machine. This elastic is either available in 3 or 5 inch width. Personally, I think the 3 inch is a little bit more workable for many of our waistlines and can be attached right to the top of the waistline just by allowing about 3/8 inch seam allowance. Or you can look for the sport type of elastic.
Oh, I didn't know that.
It has the sew areas.
I thought it was just intrinsic to the fabric.
1/2 inch apart. We simply need to sew in
the shiny side of the
at your local fabric store. It will make
wax paper.
Fun. Next time we'll be back with more super quick knit techniques. Bye for now.
Part 2. This is a 3-part series. Sewing with Nancy, Super Quick Knits,
Welcome to
Part
Sewing
2.
With Nancy and to our second program on Super Quick Knits. Today I'm going to give you some hints on sewing with knits to both stabilize and then to be very creative with it. First of all, the stabilizing part of the sewing with the knits. So often we need to use fusibles when sewing, and that obviously applies to working with knits also. In the jumpsuit that Renee is modeling, we've used a lot of fusible interfacing.
I love Renee's modeling.
We normally do not put it. For example, mm-hmm. in the zipper area, in the shoulders, and also in the knee area. Kind of unconventional ways of using fusibles to make the knit go together very quickly, but also not to blow out of shape. We'll also show you a fast zipper application for knits, which prevents the zipper from wrinkling or blowing out of shape again. After showing you kind of the very constructive parts of working with knits, today I'd like to show you also how to make a reversible top. This is kind of a reversible sweatshirt pattern that we've used two layers of interlock knit. We have the lavender side and the yellow side. This can be reversed to be worn either way, and Renee will be modeling this for us a little bit later to see how fast and fun this can be.
So we can't wait for more Renee.
Lined up for you today. We'll get set up at our sewing room area, and I'll show you how to work first of all with the stabilizers. We can all quickly sew knits and also quickly stabilize them with the use of fusible interfacing.
How does a reversible top make sense?
Stabilized with an
how do you deal with pit stains?
You may think underlining and kind of question how quick that would be, but it's going to be pressed into place. The entire jacket on the wrong side has this fusible which has been applied to a treacle.
You can't get rid of pit stains.
They're under many different brand names. It has crosswise stretch, but lengthwise stability. So it acts just like the knit. It works out perfect for sleeves like on this jacket. Since this is a treacle, it's a knit fabric that's relatively slippery. You can
I just accept pit stains.
In and out of the jacket.
I actually don't have a big problem with pit stains, I don't think.
This model size or sample size.
I don't wear a lot of white undershirts.
The treacle, the fusible treacle, cut the same size as the fashion fabric. And then simply place it wrong size together, of course, the fusible meeting the wrong side of the fabric and press into place. Using the manufacturer's instructions for the length of time to fuse this on, it gives great body to an interlock. Obviously, you wouldn't want to do this on all types of fabrics or all types of knit garments, but for a jacket, it's a great suggestion. There are many other areas that this fusible treacle can so easily be used, which will help you save a lot of time when doing the actual construction. The next garment that I'd like to talk about...
Oh no, it's going to fall off the table.
Slacks. Pajama slacks or knit slacks are so very common right now, but the only disadvantage that I have with them is that they tend to buckle out at the knee after wearing them. Here you can see kind of a knee patch from the wrong side. This is an 8-inch section. Here's the straight of grain, the grain following the grain of the fabric, and the crosswise stretch, just the way the knit has it. To find the knee area of your slacks, simply fold along the inseam, fold the crotch to the hem line, not to the hem cutting line, but to where the hem line will be hemmed later on, and find the center point above and below.
I'll be right back. Hope y'all are enjoying sewing with Nancy.
And just press into place as I've already done. So you can see it doesn't show from the right side, but just giving your knit pants a little bit more stability where it needs it, right in the knee. Another area where your pants as well as skirts need some stability if they have pockets is in the side seam area where the pocket will be placed. Here I'm going to use the knit on a little different grain. This is again cut, but it's cut on the bias. Notice a little diagonal arrow. This is a strip only about 3/4 of an inch wide. You may want to cut a few of these strips and just keep them handy in your sewing area for future reference, but I can simply press this to the wrong side of the fabric again, stabilizing that pocket. Sometimes the directions call for us to sew in a stay tape or a twill tape in this area. By fusing this in, you can see it's a lot quicker. There are two other areas where I'd like to use fusible tricot to stabilize knit fabrics instead of using, again, the sew-in type of tape. The shoulder seams are very common. And here again, we're going to utilize the grain of the interfacing. We want the most stable part to be at the shoulder seam, the crosswise. So here I have the grain running across the strip. This strip was cut like with the pocket, 3/4 of an inch wide, and then would be fused into place, meeting the cut edges to the cut edge of the fabric. Early in the program, Renee was modeling a pink jumpsuit that had a zipper down the front. And if you've ever tried to put a zipper into a lightweight knit, you know that it can be kind of aggravating at times. Well, we've solved some of that aggravation by just, again, stabilizing the center front area. This strip has the stability with the straight of grain. Wherever you want the most stable part, simply, of course, put that grain in that direction. And this is an inch and a fourth wide strip that would be pressed on both sides, both the left and the right side, down the front. Now that I have this pressed into place, I'll show you how to put in the zipper. To put a zipper into knit fabrics requires two kind of unconventional techniques. First of all, we're not going to use a zipper foot. And then for a second, I'm going to ask you to buy the zipper just a little bit longer than the opening that you need, so that the zipper tab, while sewing, can be above the seam allowance and not interfere with the stitching. Later on, we'll cut this off, but right now, we'll keep it above the fabric. We're going to work with a short little zipper right now. And I have the zipper tape pinned to the seam allowance, just to one seam allowance. I have the teeth of the zipper butting up next to the seam line. This is a very traditional technique to start off with, either machine-based by zigzag or straight stitch, sewing this right into place so that it's just being sewn to the seam allowance. Notice again that the tab is above the seam allowance. It makes it very handy. Now I'm going to close the zipper and then going to top stitch this zipper into place. Now with all zippers, if they're in knits or wovens, it's always important that you sew from the bottom to the top. So that's what we'll do this time. And I said earlier, this is a small little short zipper, but I'm using the regular zipper foot. One reason that I like to use the regular zipper foot is that it prevents the fabric from being pulled on by the zipper foot. Usually the zipper foot just has one side to the foot. This gives a more even distribution and prevents this pulling of the zipper fabric or the knit fabric. Also, that stabilizing fabric that I have in the pressed into the fabric will be very helpful when, of course, preventing this fabric from raveling. I've stitched one side. Now I'll stitch across the bottom, trying to have about the same number of stitches. And then I'll sew the other side. And after the simple top stitching, the only thing left, of course, would be to take out the remaining stitches, the basting stitches from the center seam. And now your zipper's in. So I've put this zipper in by simply top stitching on both sides with the use of a stabilizer underneath, not using a zipper foot, and of course having the zipper tab above. After you have trimmed your threads, cut open the seam, simply bar tack over the teeth and cut off the excess teeth, and your zipper's in. So now we can go on to another type of closure, basically, and that's in the pockets. You may not think of the pockets as a closure, but it is an opening area, and so it can be considered as a closure. It has to be sewn either all by the conventional machine or conventional and serger. On the pattern, there'll be markings. There'll be dots at the top and bottom of the pocket to allow for the opening area. Notice that I have the pocket fabric right here. On this knit fabric, I have used bias cut tricot, the lingerie fabric. Notice the bias arrow that I have drawn in here to show you it's cut in the bias. The reasoning for the bias is that it prevents, by being cut in the bias, from having this fabric roll a lot. It's very flat. Of course, you could use traditional fabric, the same fabric as I have here for the pocket. It just adds a little bit more bulk. The bottom tab, or the bottom dot, is where I've done a little, as well as the top, a little of the straight stitching with a conventional machine. This cannot be sewn totally by the serger. That's why I'd like to point this out to you. Because of the blade of the serger, it would cut away the pocket fabric if we sewed to this point. So just in a little area about 2 inches long, I've used the conventional stitch of the serger of the sewing machine to reinforce this. And now I can go to the serger. I'm going to kind of start sewing in midstream because of this being a long slack seam. But now I'll just simply move by guiding the fabric next to the 5/8 so that the needle thread will be right on the stitching line. And the key here is when getting to this V of how to handle this fabric. Now that the needle is in the fabric, what I'm going to do is to raise the presser foot. And I can sew this continually by holding the fabric kind of flat, opening this up flat in order to turn the corner. And then sew around the pocket. The key is getting that corner sewn. Because of the blade in the fabric, it's kind of an impossible thing. So I'll just quickly serge around the edges of this pocket. And then my pocket will be complete. With a combination of using both the serger sewing machine and a conventional machine. Now I'd like to show you this corner. We're able to turn a corner and get a corner right on the pocket, even though we did not have the ability to physically turn this. Now I'll do a reversible top. The next knit technique that I'd like to share with you is how to make a reversible top, making it out of interlock with two layers. Renee is remodeling this top for us. You can see it's an oversized sweatshirt pattern that we've made with interlock. Here's one side, and then simply reverse it to the other side, and you have a totally different look. In this top, we've mixed and matched the colors using the same color combination on both sides, or you could use contrasting colors. It doesn't matter. This is kind of a fun treatment. Basically, you're going to be making two types of sweatshirts, and then putting them together along the ribbing areas. I'll give you the details. Here we have some smaller scale samples of these sweatshirts in progress. And we have one sweatshirt almost totally complete. I've sewn the cuffs to the wrist area, to the waist area, and as well as to the neckline, putting the ribbing on in a circular motion. Again, that means by simply sewing the opening that the ribbing is going to be placed into a circle rather than a flat technique, and then sewing the ribbing obviously into a circle again. Quarter the ribbing, quarter the fabric, and sew together. I'm going to give you some hints in just a few minutes on how to sew the ribbing to the fabric without stretching the ribbing out of shape. But before we do that, let's discuss the other side of the sweatshirt. On the other side of this sweatshirt, we used a little different coloration. And this sweatshirt is just about ready for the ribbing, but we're going to use the common ribbing of the other sweatshirt for this one. So as you can see, the shoulder seams, the sleeves have been set in, the underarm seams have been sewn, and this is ready for the ribbing treatment to attach. But we have to have one little change, and that is, in the underarm seam of one of the sleeves, leave about a 6-inch opening. This will be kind of the magic opening where I'll pull the other shirt through so we can make this reversible. So now, the shirts are almost ready to be put together. But before we do this, I'd like to detail with you how to put the ribbing on the sweatshirt without stretching this out of shape. It's so important to kind of change our thoughts a little bit about putting the ribbing on so that it's not pulled out of shape at the seam line. Let's go to the sewing machine and do that right now. I'm sure many of us have put ribbings on t-shirts and sweatshirts numerous times. And we've always been taught in the past to quarter the ribbing, quarter the fabric, pin the quarter marks together, and then stretch the ribbing to meet the fabric. This is the way I've done it for years, but Naomi Baker, a sewing specialist, gave me this hint on how to sew the ribbing to the fabric without stretching the ribbing. Her reasoning is because when stretching the ribbing, many times the seam gets wavy, bowed out of shape. We can ease in the fabric in the back very simply, and I'll show you how to do this. Obviously, I have my ribbing quartered to the sleeve area, and I'm going to sew with the ribbing up. Now this could be done at the serger or at the conventional sewing machine as I'm doing now. It doesn't really matter. Now in order to ease this lower layer without stretching this top layer, you have to do kind of a new little technique. And that is I put my two fingers between the fabric and the ribbing so that I can slightly ease the fabric into place. Now I'm not going to push it or tug it in there, but just gently ease it as I'm sewing. Now, I'm sewing about 1/4 inch from the edge, or 3/8 inch from the edge, and if you have 5/8 inch seam allowances allowed on your ribbing, please do trim the seams by 1/4 inch so that you just have 3/8 inch seam. And then as you're going around, sewing again with the ribbing on top, with these two fingers between the layers of the fabric, gently ease the lower layer into place, without, as I was just doing now, but without stretching that top layer. The feed dog will bite the fabric, will ease it into place, and then you will not have a lot of stitches that have been stitches of the thread sewn into the seam to cause this to ravel or to bow out of shape. I kind of like this technique of gently easing the two together. You still have the nice effect. It still stretches because we're using a straight or a zigzag stitch, but yet it does not have the great difficulty of a lot of thread in the seam causing it to bow out. To make a reversible sweatshirt after sewing all the ribbings onto the neckline, the cuff, and the waistline requires kind of turning the garments inside out. Here you're looking at the wrong sides of both of the tops. Here on this top, of course, we do not have the ribbing attached, but on this one it's all complete, as I just showed you how to attach the ribbing in place. You're looking at the fronts, and both shirts have the wrong sides out, so the fronts of both sides. First, we're going to put these together. They're going to kind of join hands at the cuff area, the wrist. In all instances, when making this a reversible shirt, we're going to tuck the ribbing inside so it's out of the way. I have the lower edge of this wrist area quartered as if I were going to put ribbing on right now, but I am in some extent, but because I'm just going to pin it to the other cuff. And I'm just simply going to match it at all the quarter marks, pinning this into place, and then sewing it together. Now when sewing this together, I like to sew it on a conventional machine, not a serger. If you've already serged the ribbing onto the cuff, that's just fine. But now the next step is to sew with the stitching side up, the side that we've already stitched. Here you can see how you stitch following the stitching line, sewing the cuff in place, sewing in a circular motion. So after sewing all this in place, you can see that this is just pinned right now, but this is how the cuff would be attached at the lower edge. Then after attaching the cuff area, we're going to attach the area around the neckline. Here we kind of have some gymnasts here because we're going to put one shirt on top of the other like they're standing meeting heads. Here you can see the top without the ribbing is meeting the top with the ribbing. Again, the trick is to tuck the ribbing inside. So the ribbing is going to be tucked inside, and then we're simply going to meet so that right sides again are together. And just pin it all around the edges, meeting it at the quarter marks. And when sewing, once again follow that same premise of sewing so that you're sewing with the stitching side up, the side that has already been sewn side up, so you can sew right in the well of the seam. After it has been attached at the neckline, as I have on this sample, then we'll attach the other sleeve. It's kind of at a funny position right now. It looks like you're never going to be able to get into this type of shirt. It's attached at the wrist, at the neckline, and then you would attach it at the other wrist. Again, tucking the ribbing inside, matching the quarter marks, and pinning so they'd all three be sewn. If you'd like to make it a little bit more secure, you could bar tack the seam allowances together at the end of the shoulder seam so that when you're taking your garment on and off, it doesn't come apart at this time. Now, after this step has been completed, then we're going to turn this so that the side without the ribbing at the hem is on the outside. And your shirt is almost looking done. And I'm simply going to pull like magic the sleeve out, and you can see now this sleeve has a cuff, and pulling out the other side, that sleeve would also have a cuff. And the last step is to go through that little 6-inch opening. Remember I had you leave a 6-inch opening in the sleeve, and through the opening, dig down.
I am back.
And tuck again.
Are we still on the reversible sweater?
Tuck that ribbing
inside. It looks like it.
And then meet the right sides together.
This is Nancy's magnum opus for super quick knits. This is how you know you're truly a master of super quick knits, if you can make a reversible sweater.
The whole seam. It may look a little unconventional at this point, but here you can see how the waistline has been put together.
Howdy.
One waistline is attached to the other, and it's all in a
I have some digestive biscuits and a cup of tea.
Opening, turn this right side
Don't tell
up,
Richard.
And I have a completed sweatshirt. While I'm pulling this right side out, we'll take a pause, and I'll show you it completed when we come back. Off camera, I've been finishing turning this right side out, going through the opening of this cute little top, making it reversible. Remember, there was a 6-inch opening, which I used kind of like pulling a rabbit out of a hat to turn this garment inside out. And presto, with a little hand sewing in the center of this armhole seam, we'll have a reversible top.
So many bread cards.
This one happens to be white on one side with blue trim, and it happens to be peach and yellow on the inside. It's kind of a fun top to work with. Just another quick knit technique that you can apply. Next time on Sewing with Nancy, we'll have more on super quick knits. We'll be specializing on using ribbings.
Oh, this is just part two.
Knit fabrics to make a cute jacket. See you then. Bye for now.
We're going
to
make a cute jacket. In part three, the final part of super quick knits. This tape is a compilation of three different 20-minute segments. Ooh, look at that dress.
Third program on super quick knits. Today in this program, I'm going to be specializing on using ribbings as accents. As you can see in the shirt that I'm wearing, I have a Johnny collar accent, a collar that I added later on after completing the shirt. We're also going to be working with double ribbing, adding ribbing leg warmers, and making this fun top that we've added after the ribbing has been sewn onto the neckline, this tab front that can change a simple looking crew neck top into a special old shirt. We've made a lot of our garments today in children's sizes, but of course they can be for adults or teens as well. We're going to start off with a double ribbed effect. And here you can see
so the little shirt where we've added Nancy actually had a Bell's palsy.
Giving it a special emphasis.
Sombra, she got it as a toddler when she had some sort of like infection.
When working with ribbing, keep in mind
so that's why her face is a little
ribbing by the yard or by the inch to
has that expression.
Never use this crease if possible. At least in the same
she was apparently, according to her sunny shirt. Oh my God! According to her Wikipedia article, very vocal about. You know, she considered herself the poster child for Bell's palsy.
We can use ribbing as an accent, but a double ribbing accent is even
she owned
more attractive.
It.
As you saw earlier, this shirt has double ribbing accents at the neck, at the wrist, and the waistline. And we varied the wrist to give it an attractive accent. Let's first of all start at the neckline. The yellow was the suggested ribbing width given on the pattern guide. We simply made the second ribbing just a little bit larger. You can see that if you're determining the ribbing, you need to double the width that's needed because obviously the ribbing is going to be folded in half. But then the key for both pieces is to, with the length, use the pattern guide, but then add one extra inch in the length. The reason for adding one extra inch is that later on, when you're going to be sewing the two ribbings together, it doesn't have quite as much give or stretch because this is a little tighter, obviously because of the double width. So for your second layer of ribbing, in this instance, we doubled the width and then added two extra seam allowances.
That is very Vault-Tec, isn't
it? For the cuff area, we have added the smaller width as the second layer, as well as
for the 101 on the back.
You can see it's kind of a fun combination. Really, there aren't any hard, fast rules right here to follow. After you've cut out the widths of the ribbing, then sew them together at the side seams individually. Just sew each side seam and then turn right side out as you would normally and then pin them together along the neckline. Here they are serged, or you could zigzag them together so that they would be treated as one when inserted into the neckline or wrist or the waist. And also keep in mind that when doing this, you may want to serge or zigzag them together with just a little bit of a narrower width. When you're later going to be sewing all layers together, you're going to use a wide width of a stitch. And by having a little bit narrower stitch here, you're going to be sure that this seam allowance or this basting stitch is enclosed, so it will never show from the other side. Quarter the ribbing, quarter the neckline, insert it as normal, and you have a double ribbing effect. It's kind of fun. Our next ribbing treatment adds an extra length.
Wait, it sews a jump rope into the arms of the sweater?
This look is very great for teens, adults, as well as kids. And here you can see our outfit for kids, and it's kind of a fun one to work with. Let's discuss how to add the extra ribbing lengths for these particular pieces.
This tape is from 1988.
Laid out, and here I'd like to show you some close-ups of
I really love the 1988 fashion.
Particularly works at the bottom of the pants where we're adding a lot of length. Usually
they were very into solid colors.
Length cuff at the bottom. Here we have a finished length of 12 inches. So that when these are worn, obviously they can double as leg warmers. For growing kids, they're great because your pants really will never be too short. You just make the leg warmers a little bit shorter. The cutting of the ribbing is really the only different situation here. And at the bottom of the cuff, we simply cut, as you see here, the length 24 inches long. So it's quite long. And then just sew it together, double it with a large cuff, putting it on the bottom of the pants. Really no different, but just working with such a large piece. At the cuff, around the sleeve, the bottom of the sleeve, we doubled the total length.
Oh, that's very sweet, circle not squared.
Another growth technique, but also looks very nice with the extra leg.
My mom made me clothes when I was a little kid, and my grandmother made us quilts.
We simply made the waistline just a little bit.
My grandma was a huge quilter.
Finished waistline at the rib.
So we always had like.
Rib, we cut 12 inches plus two seam allowances.
She made every grandchild a quilt when they were born, like a baby quilt.
A little bit more ribbing, I should say, a lot more ribbing when making.
And then we just had quilts all around the house.
Next, we have a tab front added to a basic crew neck top, and this tab front can be added to any garment, just making it a little bit more special looking. Here are the step-by-step samples for this particular tab front. On the front of the shirt, before putting on the ribbing, I've marked a 1-inch tab opening. Make the length as long as you'd like, but make certain that the width is 1 inch wide. I've marked the opening of the tab with a washable marking pen. Then cut 2 strips for the tab, and you can make them out of different colors as you saw from our sample. Each tab will be 3 inches wide. And the length will be the length of the tab.
I have quilts that my grandma made, and then I have quilts.
Each piece. As you can see,
there's one that's really special to me because it was really special to my mom. One of my mom's like favorite things about running a sewing machine store was
inside the tab I have
that she got to interact with old nice old quilting ladies.
For buttons and buttonholes.
Because her mother was a nice old quilting lady.
Stack the tabs together.
And after grandma, it was long after grandma had died, but there was a woman who
but notice I'm not stacking.
This very, very sweet old woman, Miss Kratzer, that came into the store and took classes and stuff and was really nice to my mom, and my mom really loved her. And she would, like, you know, when it was my mom's birthday or like one of our birthdays, like my mom's kids' birthdays, Miss Kratzer would bring it, like bake a cake and bring it into the store.
So that it's just extending up 1 inch from the bottom.
And we have this quilt.
We have
that somehow, like, my mom had these boxes and boxes of fabric that from my grandma's house after she died that she had, you know, bought for quilting and never used. And so Miss Kratzer made my mom a quilt out of my grandma's quilting fabric. And she just loved it so much.
Cut open the tab front. And here you can see the tab front has been cut open. The shoulder seams have been stitched together. And the ribbing has been placed on. Now the ribbing is not continuous. I didn't bother sewing the seam together at the center back. Here we have the opening placed at the center front. Now after the ribbing has been placed on, we're simply going to flip the tabs up and sew them in. And right now I'll go to the sewing machine to show you this. After sewing the tabs to the bottom of the shirt, remember, I cut open the center front of the tab. At the very bottom, so that I got a sharp point, I cut a wedge to each point at the bottom. And you can see that detail right here. The next step is to sew the side seams of each of the tabs. On the red tab, I've already clean finished the top. Notice how there's a fold at the top. I determined the length by simply folding up the tab and meeting it to the cut length or the finished length of the side, holding that fabric taut. And then to know where that seam should be sewn, just place a little nip or clip in the sides. And then turn this so that you have right sides together and sew across the top, trimming off any of the excess seam allowances that you may have. Obviously, on the red side, it's already completed that way, and that's the way you do both sides. Now, to sew the side seam, we're going to meet all the cut edges together. It's important to start off by meeting
niblet,
these two cut
a little
edges
nip
here so that they're lining
a little nip of hops,
well
I guess.
Flush at the top. I'm going to sew from the garment side, so I'll pin from the garment side. And then pinning
Clippy.
So that all the cut edges all the way down are meeting together. This is going to be a half inch seam allowance, and I'm going to start at the very bottom. Start sewing.
Bella, you did the thing we were all thinking of. How dare you?
The very point to catch all the fabric, because it's been clipped in this area.
Let's see if it works.
Now, on a ravelly fabric, you may want to support the bottom area with interfacing, but on a knit, it works very fine.
Snipper, a little nip clip.
Now, again, I have a half-inch seam allowance.
Looks like a broadcast monitor.
And I have my machine set at a very short stitch length, about 15 to 18 stitches per inch. Now, you may want to restitch this bottom again just after doing the initial stitching, but now I'm using my half-inch seam and sewing from bottom to top. That way I feel very strongly you'll get that bottom nice and square. Then double check at the neck edge that the layers are meeting perfectly, again so that every layer will be nice and square at the top. Now I'll reverse this a little bit and check my work. When you turn this right side out, you first want to check to make certain that the top is
flush with
each other and that the bottom
a nip
is
of pippy snip mip bips.
And now sew the other side. After you complete, put your button and buttonholes in, and your top is ready to wear.
Ah, so many generic ghosts.
The next knit technique that I'd like to show you is how to make a super quick knit skirt combining ribbing and regular interlock fabric. I'd like to show you the pattern that we started off with. From the pattern book, I took this illustration of a pattern that has a yoked top and then a gathered or pleated skirt to the bottom. The skirt that I'm wearing is an adaptation of this pattern, where the top yoke is double layer of ribbing, and then instead of pleating the lower part of the skirt, we simply gathered it to the skirt for a fast application. I'd like to show you the advantage of working with this type of pattern just to make it a fun, quick skirt. On this little girl's skirt,
oh my God,
double ribbing at the top. Now the nice part,
you know what you did, Clippy,
is that the elastic can be hidden in this double ribbing. There isn't any top stitching showing from the top side, because the elastic is simply sewn to the wrong side, or the inside of the ribbing. It's kind of a fun application without that telltale sign of elastic being in here. I'll show you how to go about changing your pattern just a little bit. On the yoke pieces of the pattern, I have folded under the seam allowance that is allowed, or the casing allowance at the top, so that the top of the pattern is where normally the waistline.
You can really hear her Wisconsin accent come out in those O vowels.
The pattern piece of this section,
the York
size. And on this particular pattern piece, I have pinned to the top of the finished yoke, a double size of the, in this instance, the back yoke. So you have double the time. And this will be cut out of ribbing fabric. Here I have the ribbing cut out of the fabric, and I've simply sewn the side seams. And I have already marked this and quartered it for the elastic. Before we discuss this, let's just talk a little bit about the fabric and how to prepare it for this step. On a circular, when you have your circular yoke, the front and sewn to the back, we have it flat here so that you can see, simply press the crease where the waistline will be finished. Notice that the cut edges have been met. And then this is the right side of the fabric. Then on the inside, you can quarter and mark the various positions, quartering the waistline. Like with all
say
elastics,
sorry.
Make this elastic into quarters, mark it into quarters. And this is 3 inch wide, 3/4 inch wide, or 1 inch wide, non-roll type of
Haley's
elastic.
Parents say sorry.
Put this around my waistline so it was comfortable, adding about a half of an inch of a seam.
So even that is not 100% indicator of Canadianness.
Then after quartering this piece, and quartering, of course, the fashion fabric.
But they're basically Canadian.
I'm going to put the elastic on one side of the fold, and it's just a hair below the fold, so that when the fabric is folded down, it will come at the right amount. So you simply pin the quarters together, and then I'll show you how to sew the elastic to the garment.
How do Canadians say, I beg your pardon?
To apply the elastic into this yoke area, I've already stitched the elastic to the wrong side of the ribbing, on one half of it. And you can see that I've stitched on both ends of the elastic, on both sides. To make it a little bit easier for you to see,
beg pardon?
This on a flat piece of fabric. The circle made it a little bit difficult to see.
Excuse me.
Now I have the elastic already quartered into the wrong side of the ribbing. And when placing the ribbing, making certain that it's placed just a hair below the fold. I have darkened the fold of the fabric so that you're...
Well, yeah, that's kind of interesting, isn't it? There's multiple usages for
fold, right at that fold,
both, like, excuse me and sorry and beg your pardon can be used to mean I apologize, and they can also mean please say that again.
The top side.
Even sorry. Like, if you say sorry, that means you're sorry. If you say sorry, that means you want them to repeat the thing they said.
Keep on going on both sides until you're complete. Now, of course, this will be done in a circle, but after you have both sides sewn, as on this sample, simply meet the cut edges, the lower cut edges, sandwiching the elastic in the ribbing. And you can see what a nice kind of concealed waistline treatment this ends up being. On the skirt that I'm wearing, and also on the little sample skirt that we have, instead of pleating the lower edges of the skirt, we simply gathered them to meet the ribbing area. And the fabric can be easily gathered by the sewing machine or serger. And I'd like to share with you one of my favorite ways of gathering fabric with a traditional sewing machine. That's again using the same zigzag stitch that we just used to attach the elastic into the ribbing area. What I like to do is find my top thread, and I'll pull this top thread and guide my presser foot next to the cut edge of the fabric. Take just one stitch by turning the flywheel by hand and then pull up that bobbin thread. It will come up. Notice that I'm pulling that bobbin thread extra long, and pull this bobbin thread as long as the area that you're going to gather. So this time I needed quite a long length. pull the bobbin thread. It's coming up through the fabric. Then set the machine at a zigzag, about a medium width and medium length. I'm going to widen the width just a little bit. And instead of using two rows of basting threads together, I'm simply zigzagging over this cord. And just sew all the way around, in this instance, the waistline edge. Now, I'll do the whole thing a little bit later, but I'd like to show you now that all you have to do to gather it is simply pull the cord. Next, we'll do a Johnny collar. The next super quick knit technique that I'd like to share with you is adding a Johnny collar. As you can see, that's the collar that's been added to the shirt that I'm wearing. It can be added on any basic crew neck shirt, obviously with just a little ribbing at the neckline. We're going to add a Johnny collar to this shirt. And in order to do this, we need to measure the neckline. I'd like to measure the neckline after the ribbing has been applied. I'm simply going to fold the garment in half and measure just half of it, guiding the tape measure in the seam line. This happens to measure 9 inches. The total width of that neckline is 18 inches, or double that tape measure width. Now, making the collar this size would have it too large. Usually when we're working with ribbing, many times we cut the ribbing 2/3 the size of the neckline. That would be a little bit too small for the collar because there's a lot of bulk, so we have to make it just a little bit bigger. So the proportion that works extremely well is to cut the collar so it's 3/4 the size of the neckline, rather than getting out a pen and paper.
I have to go grab a tape to make sure it's rewound.
Be right back. What I quickly like to do is use my tape measure again. I have it folded in half at the 9-inch mark, so I have a total of 18 inches, and then I simply just bring that fold again to 18 inches. And then on the new fold, it reads 13.5 inches. That's 3/4 of the neckline. So I've quartered the tape measure, just like you would with elastic, kind of using the tape measure instead. We would need 13 inches plus 2/4-inch seam allowances, or a total of 14 inches for this ribbing. So that's the total length that you see right here. Now for the width, the collar band that's already on here acts as a stand for the new collar that's coming on. So the ribbing acts for a stand. The collar has to be at least double this size. And since, as you'll see later, that we're doubling the fabric, you could multiply the finished band by 4. Double the finished band by 4 and then add 2 seam allowances. We always have to add those in the seam allowances.
Wait, is that why they're so big on traffic circles now in Wisconsin? Because 4-way stops are just
folded in half,
impossible.
As I have done here, and then sew the
because no one will yield the right of way.
1/4-inch seam allowance on both sides. Make sure that you only.
Sorry, everyone yields the right of way. No one will accept the right of way. No one will assert the right of way.
A little bit too small. And now we'll quickly turn these collar points out. Notice that I didn't use any interfacing in this area. It's not necessary because this is going to give with the collar. And try not to press it if all possible. Then after sewing those side seams and turning it right side out, just overlap the center fronts by about 1/2 inch. On this sample, I have overlapped the center fronts by 1/2 inch and then zigzag the edges together of the ribbing so it'll be easier to apply. Then simply quarter the ribbing of the collar, quarter the garment, and sew them together. And I'll show you this after this short pause. Off camera, I stitched the Johnny collar to the neckline of this shirt. I quartered the collar and I also quartered the neckline area and then stitched the seam allowances together following the basic stitching line that I used for initially attaching the ribbing. I used a straight stitch rather than a serger. You can see I just sewed all the layers together. This collar, when completed, can be worn up like I have on my shirt where the collar points are standing up, or of course they can be turned under like a traditional collar. It's just a fun accent made of ribbing. Again, made it 3/4 the size of the neckline and making certain that the length of the collar will go over the ribbing. And usually you obviously have it double the length, or I've made a little bit more this time to have a little bit more play in the area. Again, a fun accent to add. I hope you've enjoyed this series on super quick knits. They're fun to work with. If you haven't worked with them for a while, get out your sewing machine or serger and sew up some quick knits for yourself. Bye for now.
This educational videotape has been brought to you in part by Pfaff, simply the best European line of...
God, look at those 80s sewing machines.
...by Pellon, quality products crafted with pride. By Ginger, a tradition of quality from scissors and...
Stretchy Sam!
the McCall Pattern Company.
Oh,
the
stretchy Sam.
Name in contemporary home sewing patterns. And by Nancy's Notions Sewing Catalog, featuring specialty sewing books and notions.
And that was Sewing with Nancy, Super Quick Knits. I quite enjoyed that. I wasn't expecting to get as much cool 80s fashion as we did. Let's see. I found a tape. This isn't on the thing. I was reminiscing about my mom, and I realized I have, and talking a lot about her sewing machine business, and I have this tape of commercials that were produced for her store. So I figured I'd pop that in and take a look, because it's just 3 30-second spots. Oh, gotta get Nancy up. Video of the month. All right. Oh yeah, I don't have that set to focus. It's fine. How do I mute that? I don't know. I forget. There we go. God, that's a lot. It's still playing in my ears. These were... Yeah, oh, there we go.
Have you always dreamed of owning a FOF? Well, now you can with Sewing Machine Mart and the affordable new Creative 2124 with free software package. Save $500. Embroider large, beautiful designs and have 52 stitches for sewing and decorative projects. With FOF's exclusive IDT, you'll enjoy precision top and bottom fabric feed. So whether you're quilting, hemming those heavy blue jeans, or stitching garments or home deck, FOF's heavy-duty needle power can handle it. Come see it today. Sewing Machine Mart, since 1950. We'll take care of you.
These are just like the commercials that the cable company produced for you. Ah, why does it do that for every one of them? This is some great test pattern. It's really loud. It's really loud in my ears right now. There we go.
Would you like to stop working for someone else and enjoy your own business? Now you can with Sewing Machine Mart and the new Baby Lock Embroidery.
Oh, this thing. You'll receive this thing was huge.
Delivery and setup, supplies, everything you need to get started. We'll help you devise your startup plan now, then help you in the future with...
My mom made all these hats and vests and things.
So why are you waiting? Come by today and take advantage of our introductory special pricing while we have 0% financing available. Since 1950, Sewing Machine Mart in Homewood will see you through to success.
That's not a MAGA hat on the machine, by the way. That this was from like 2003. Ghost of, please stand by. Thank you, Reed. Oh boy. The deafening beep in my ears combined with Peter Gabriel. friend. Oh, a baby lock. I get it. Lenny. Love him. I have no way of pausing alerts. So I'll just pause the tape. I can rewind and we can hear more beep. Oh, no, you're fine. Don't apologize for giving me 200 bits. Thank you, Slick Duke. 200 bits, ghost of a baby lock on a sewing... Oh, okay. There's a... Yeah, a baby. There's a baby.
Sewing Machine Mart in Homewood is your authorized Pfaff and Baby Lock dealer with a machine for every need and every budget. Come in today for your very own Baby Lock sewing embroidery machine with $2,500 software and gift package, or free sewing cabinet or serger with your new Pfaff Creative 2144 sewing embroidery machine. We offer classes and we support you beyond the sale with free service and classes, and we service all makes and models. Since 1950, Sewing Machine Mart in Homewood has the one that's right for you.
Okay, and I believe that's it. There should be no more beeping. Yeah, that's it. I have a bunch of these tapes sitting around because my mom had them in her house. They made a lot of... No, it's not still there. It's technically still... It's a really weird feeling, like, driving by because my mom's business partner continued to run the store and... eventually moved it to a different town in Alabama because he, like, didn't want to live in Birmingham anymore. And so they moved. So I think they're still around in Springville, Alabama. But the actual, like, store location got torn down and rebuilt as, like, a trendy new shopping center. So it was a really weird feeling to drive by and see it, like, raised in just a flat concrete pile of rubble. Yeah, all things must end. I've got time for a Mighty Machines. What do you say we watch a Mighty Machines? Perk us up here. This is Mighty Machines at the fire station. So... I'll tell you right now, it was like about 5 to 10 minutes in, and I rewound it. So I would say not rewound. There was that much tape left on the reel. It was unkind. But I did rewind it because I didn't want to sit here waiting. They dive and drive, flash and splash, tow and mow, tug and lug. Those mighty machines are on the go, and today they're taking you along. Get ready to roll with the mighty machines as they tell their on-the-job stories and take you along on adventures you'll never forget. At the fire station, you'll make friends with Pumper, the bright red fire truck, and ride along for a special treat, a visit to the fire school. You'll learn about firefighting from Sparky the Hydrant and King the platform truck. See for yourself how they pump, spray, and and stay prepared to keep us safe. So answer the call, we've got a busy day ahead. All right, we're going to learn about pumping and spraying. Pumping and dumping and sprumping. Here on Mighty Machines at the fire station. Here we go. Tape 172. Oh, it worked. All of these, like, on-the-line ghosts have gone through just fine today. A firefighter with a keffiyeh. I don't understand this AI sometimes. Please do not sue us. Mighty Machines, Mighty Machines, working for you, doing mighty things there. Mighty Machines, lifting and pulling and flying so high, building a building right up to the sky, figuring out all there and never know why there. Mighty Machines. Oh, it's the Canadian Railroad. Every girl and boy. Oh! He's just swallowed up by that coat. At the fire. Oh, yeah, this one wasn't rewound because it was in the wrong case the first time we watched the other Mighty Machines.
This is where I live. It's a fire hall.
So I had to rewind it from this point.
Come on, boys, out of bed. Let's get going. It's fire school day. Here come the firemen. Bruce? Peter? Jerry? And Mark? We make a great team.
Sliding down the stripper pole. Woman.
Before I leave for fire school, the firemen give me a complete checkup. I always have to be in top condition. This is my control panel. These are the gauges and handles that the firemen use to control how much water I put onto the fire.
That's definitely a firefighter.
This red knob is my throttle. It controls the pressure of the water. You'll see it in action later.
Of course. Of course.
Hey, there's Mark. He's going to check the oxygen tank and mask. The firemen wear these tanks on their backs when they go inside a burning building. It helps them breathe when they're in a room filled with...
Cobby. Okay.
It's very important that the hose has no leaks.
Twisty.
Yep, everything seems fine. Now, back behind my driver's seat where it belongs.
Sprinkleberry. I love the idea of a heavy truck that just, like, dumps oil on the ground in front of itself as it's driving.
That way, we never have to search for it in an emergency. Let's take a look at what I carry in my compartments. These are the flares. We use them to keep traffic away when we're working. This big fan blows the smoke away. That way they can see a lot better.
Oh, it's like Booberry. He's Sprinkleberry.
We have to be ready for just about...
It does sound like Tails,
so
doesn't it?
We always make sure we carry a toolbox. I wonder if you keep your room this neat. You'll never guess what's stored in here. Nozzles! They attach to my hoses and let the firemen control the spray of the water.
I thought they were camera lenses.
nozzles for all kinds of fires.
You like that one?
As you can see, all the firemen are really busy. Just like any good team, we each have a job to do, and we all work together. You probably recognize a lot of these tools. There are screwdrivers, a hacksaw, a hammer, and a flashlight.
Oh, that's a great Eggman. And a great Sonic.
I'm prepared.
That's a blue hedgehog? Oh my god.
I know, it's not dark now. But sometimes I have to rush to a fire at night. That's why I carry my own set of lights.
Sprinkles.
Now for a surprise.
It's gonna get
dark. Like good prayer, bear. Oh my god, he can open like that. 100 bits from Will Peter. Fun fact, there's a show called Tacoma FD, created by the same people that created Super Troopers. It's about... Thank you, Jace. It's about firefighters at Tacoma in Tacoma, Seattle, who mostly just respond to calls or get misadventures while occasionally fighting fires. Sounds fun.
My checkups happen every day, right here at the fire hall. Oops, looks like I need some oil.
He had a flat metallic face, yeah.
Finished, and down I come.
They're putting my head back on. They pumped oil into my neck. Make sure your throat is properly lubricated.
No, never mind. Yes, this is filmed in Canada. We learned the first time around that it is,
Well, now it's the fireman's turn to go and get ready.
That it's also released in, Canadian French as Super Machine.
Since we're only going to the fire school today, we don't have to rush. If this were a real emergency, these guys would be running as fast as they could. The firemen keep all their gear down here in the garage with me. When the fire alarm rings, they can get ready in a flash.
We could watch the French version, assuming it's like NTSC from Canada and someone sends it in. Or I find it at a thrift store, miraculously.
All aboard! Here we go!
We've just got so many tapes, though. I really do need to scan more tapes soon. The thing about a PAL VCR is it would... So actually, Joshy D has... He let me know that he has, just laying around, a multi-region... like international VCR that can play multiple like tapes from all different regions, which would be, I think, the most practical way of doing it.
Why don't I have a little bit?
But I also am not.
Hey, there's my friend Sparky.
There's plenty of potential in just NTSC tapes.
Hiya, Sparky.
I don't really want to expand my hardware like that at this point.
Hard to keep you looking so shiny.
You know me, Sparky. I like
a PAL VCR, like a VCR from Europe, would require a voltage converter.
Well, why don't don't we practice using your hose?
So it would just be a lot and take up a lot of space. So I
the first thing I've got to do.
I'm sticking with what I got for now.
Like sparking. This is where I get my water from.
Please no. Please no. Oh yeah, hook me up. Hook me up to the hose.
The hose from Sparky is then attached to my intake valve.
200 bits from Reed, ghost of Sonic the Hedgehog wearing a fedora. It figures it out. Oh, that is Sonic the Hedgehog wearing a fedora. The speed lines and everything. Beautiful. Thank you, Reed.
The yellow hoses take the water from my pump and spray it on the fire.
I think Bella is just making a internet cultural reference. A very accursed internet cultural reference.
Well, you know, Pumper, the more we practice, the better prepared we'll be when we go to a real fire.
Who is Pumper? Is Pumper the hydrant? What's going on? Oh, Pumper is the fire truck. Sparky is the hydrant.
That's really neat.
Pumpy.
Before the hoses are put away, the firemen make sure they're washed and cleaned.
According to the back of the box, Pumper is the bright red fire truck and Sparky is the hydrant. And King, who I don't think we've met yet, is a platform truck.
So neatly that when we respond to a real fire, they don't get tangled.
Aw, Pumper and Sparky.
Well, Sparky, I guess that's it for today.
Not just yet, Pumper. Today's a special day. I've asked King to drop by.
King? All right. Let me surprise him. I'll be back in a minute, Sparky.
Don't be too long. King's gonna need your help today.
Okay, so that's Sparky. He's just like a cylinder. It's really, really hard to project. Oh my god. Did they do that for Sparky? Was I just not paying attention?
Platform truck. And this is my crew.
Now remember, King, before you bring out your stabilizer legs, make sure you put down your metal pads and block your wheels.
I know, Sparky. I know.
If in the fiction of this universe the truck is sentient and is putting down the stabilizing arms itself, what are the humans for? Again, I think the truck, like, possesses and telepathically controls the humans. Oh, 200 bits from Reed. A dog with cat ears. Dexter. Like, from Jack and Dexter, I guess. It's very good.
Hey, King!
Well, what do you know? It's Pumper.
How you been doing?
Okay, this is from the North York Fire Department, which I assume North York is the capital of British Columbia. North York is one of the 6 administrative districts of Trantool.
Well, let's get to work, King.
It's located in the northern area of Trantool, north of Ontario Highway 401.
Hey, Pumper, let's give Sparky a rest today and use the fire hydrant out on the street.
That's a great idea.
But before you go, make sure we're hooked up so I can use the water from the hydrant.
Whenever we respond to an emergency, the pumper is always the first one to arrive. My main job is to get water from the hydrant to the fire.
Hey, 1,000 bits from Facebook. Welcome to Beats to Fight Fires 2, featuring Maria Martinez and her jazz band Song of the Sun. All right, excellent. We will jazz it up for you, Facebook.
Today, we're only going to use one hose. But if it was a...
What are they doing to Sparky?
Three hoses. Once the water is turned on, King can use his hoses.
This is a little disappointed compared to the previous Mighty Machines, where they were like, we're gonna blow up a building! And then they did. And this one, it's like, we only have the one hose today, but sometimes we have three. Anyway, here, look at how the hose works. I think Sparky can move around freely. He just does it off camera. 200 bits from Reed, Ghost of a Jazz Band Under the Sun.
One of the firemen uses the controls.
Ooh, the double sax attack. You can, I learned from SimCity that you can control fires by just demolishing all the buildings around the fire. That is like, you know.
Safety is very important. That's why the firemen always.
It may not be the most. To the basket. It may not be the kindest and most comforting way of fighting fires, but it is effective. Oh, it is King. Fire King. What is that? What is that demolished car doing there? I guess that's King's snack for later. I would assume that King eats cars for sustenance. Yeah, that little skinny building with multiple floors, it's like just a big staircase that they can set on fire a bunch. It's definitely a training site for... I actually have a pre-Golden VCR tape that I went through at one point of MTV's Road Rules, where they had the kids like go to Australia and learn how to... It was Road Rules Down Under. And they went to a fire station and learned how to fight fires. I need to manually restart the chatbot. Stand by.
Looks like we're already down here on the ground.
We did it.
Perfect.
Oh yeah, man, road rules in real world.
By using the nozzle,
they were like the original reality shows.
Different things, like misting. Misting soaks the whole area so that the fire doesn't spread.
Yeah, but why use water to wet things down when you could just use the bulldozer icon?
My arm can stretch
to make things disappear. A building can't catch on fire if it's instantly gone.
I'm so big. While two firemen are in the basket up high, the other men are working down below. It's been a great day. All the equipment is in perfect shape, and the guys are all set for a real emergency.
Listen, I just know that's how it works in SimCity. All of that dust would probably be a good fire break anyway. If you cover everything in a fine layer of dust, then it's less flammable.
Don't you follow Pumper back to the fire hall.
I'll see you next time, King.
Aw, Uwu fire truck. The crowd is on fire. You can't cut back on funding. You will regret this. $200 from Reed, a water humanoid and a fire humanoid boxing. Ooh.
I had a lot of fun today, and I hope you did too.
Water doesn't have to wear gloves.
Thanks for visiting, and come on back anytime.
Mighty Machines. Let's see if it gives us voice credits. Working for you, doing mighty things there. Mighty Machines. Mary Ellen Shrimpton. Greg Blanchard and Gold Rutherford.
Machines. Hear them roar, watch them soar, sit right down and see. There are stories to enjoy for every girl and boy. Mighty Machines.
Oh, no, the Mighty Machines song is not not in the list. But you know what is? Song of the Sun. A Mallow Film production. I forget. I don't think we get promos at the end of these. Yeah. All right. Yeah. The first time I heard the song, like, you know, you know, as soon as they set up the rhyme, you know, there's so much to enjoy. You know, the it's going to be for every girl and boy. All right, folks. Thank you for being here today. We have a Song of the Sun for you. Courtesy of Jasibuk. That was Mighty Machines at the Fire Station. We'll clear that tape. Head on over to goldenvcr.com/tapes. Look at them tapes. Favorite your tapes. Tape your favorites. And I'll see you back here most likely Wednesday at 10 a.m. Let's do some Song of the Sun. That's going to be boom. Here we go. Thank you to all for your cheer ghosts and your resubs, and a special thanks to whoever gave 20 gift subs to the community. Much appreciated. When you stream on Twitch, you learn that dancing is all in the shoulders. Triangle Man is grooving back there. I really do appreciate something new about these performances every time we rewatch a Brazilian drum song. Like, Marie is a very competent drummer. Oh, she did the little stick twirl. Farewell, everyone. Thank you for being here. See you again on Wednesday, and have a lovely week. Thank you. I should really come to expect those now, but they still surprise me. Bye, everyone.